Welcome back, then. I think that summary covers everything. I can't think of what would have been forgotten. Yes, welcome, hello. before we get started, if there's anything you feel like you want to ask or ask me about, as far as like what your character can do or kind of angle you're going to try to take, or this is the time, I suppose, before I do the foolhardy thing and try to run all these, like, technically, narratively speaking, chronologically, they're all happening simultaneously. So how much of that we'll be able to carry out simultaneously, we'll find out. I guarantee no one will be sitting on the sidelines too long. I will have random things happen. I swear I'm not going to do it. I'm gonna make sure that we all get our say in things. But if you have anything, like you want to came up with an idea, a strategy, you just want to like inquire about it ahead of time, that at least gives me some idea of like aspects to set up, goals, that sort of thing. So do any of you, just out of curiosity, have a general strategy of what you're going to do here?
No.
I already said my strategy, so.
True.
I vaguely offered something to Enya at some point. Why don't... I guess my only question is, can light make bubbles? But that's... We could do that mid-battle, that's not...
Well, it's liquid light, so...
Yeah, can liquid light make bubbles?
How would you do it?
You just take some liquid light on your fingers, and then you make a little O, and then you blow them, just like blowing bubbles with soap.
Okay.
Is that how it works? I don't know if that's how liquid light works.
It says it can't.
I don't know enough to say that it can or can't.
Look, I'm not a scientist, which means I'm perfectly capable of explaining this fantasy. Material.
Like, Araki probably doesn't know what half of the thing he makes the stands to do the thing.
How much green crack is in the sea, by the way? Like
enough to kill the crowd that you're looking at easily.
Oh no, okay.
Yeah, like more than enough, really. Probably enough to kill three or four times that amount of people. Once it's airborne, it's basically like sarin gas, you could think of it as, to people.
No pressure.
All right.
I'm sorry, what is sarin gas?
Sarin gas is a chemical agent used that's been banned in warfare.
Okay.
Basically, if I remember correctly with it, it is actually the kind of neurotoxin S.
Except, it's like a nerve gas. Okay, yeah, I know what it is. Yeah, okay. Yeah.
It does disperse with like exposure to air, but usually.
I mean, it ain't great.
It ain't great.
Fire here, no.
It ain't great no matter what you do.
All right. I'm definitely not trying to grab things at the last second.
You're not stalling for time?
No.
Oh. You're not making tokens right now?
No, my tokens are made.
You sure?
Yes.
Okay.
Look, he can put you can type as many requests as fast as you can. It's up to Midjourney to make them. That's the delay.
Mm-hmm. I wish it was that. It's not that. It's something else. The Spotify downloader that I used to try to grab music off Spotify real quick. It's gone through so many revisions lately that actually getting stuff off of it is like, it feels like a crapshoot sometimes. But it still works. So it's all you can ask for. I can still steal music.
It could still be illegal.
Yes. All right, with all of that out of the way, we open with a flashback relevant to one person in particular. Okay, just not gonna do it. That's fine. That's okay. I don't need things to work.
No. What should we be listening to? We can always look it up.
Nothing. It's fine.
No.
Stop. Judgment night. There we go. Spent so much time trying to prep this stuff to make sure I don't want to putz around with it during the session. And yet. Yep. That's okay. We open up, as I said before, on a flashback to a scene long, long ago in a land extremely far away from Guam. Near an area that is now currently known as Turkey, but in this time it's known as the Byzantine Empire, not far from that location. There is a strait that was vital to the area, the Dardanelles. And across the Dardanelles on the Asiatic side is where we find. Let's activate it. There we go. Convent set up in secret by the Empress Theodora, wife of Justinian I, at a time when there was great division sown amongst the various factions of Christianity as to the true nature of God, whether it was dualistic or singular, whether God was both man and divine, or simply the purest of man and divinity represented in one spirit. To us in the modern era, this argument maybe sounds pedantic, but at this point in history, men fought and died according to the rules of their religion, the beliefs, the philosophy that they took to heart. Metanoia, a convent created by Theodora, specifically more in line with her singular nature views. Aside from hiding and fostering those who believed in the singular nature of God, Theodora also took great pity upon those who were driven and enslaved into lives of prostitution. Thus, she conceived of and had built the Metanoia, the redemption. 500 prostitutes from Byzantium were in the darkness of night, rounded up night after night and brought there to a convent where they would seek redemption. The convent itself was quite large. And though it was mainly the prostitutes that got attention, there were others whose lives were deeply connected to the Metanoia, namely the children of the prostitutes, for without their mothers, how could they possibly fend for themselves on the street? And thus, an orphanage was opened at the Metanoia. And charged to take care of it were some of the more elderly of the nuns and sisters, though they were not the only ones. For it was here where in charge one troublesome nun in particular, one sister who had fought, had gotten drunk, had blasphemed, and done many, many blasphemous things since her time coming here, not of her own will, naturally. A voice rings out and says, "The children need their dinner. Come along now. Stop slacking, for sloth is a sin. You know this well, sister. Alsatia, where are you?" At the Metanoia, Sister Alsatia, a young, slim, tall woman, was once a prostitute on the streets. After a particularly traumatic event in which her child was stolen from her very arms by a dark-haired, dark-clothed witch, she found herself in the grips of madness until promises of redemption came straight from the lips of Theodora herself. And so she came to this place and found it unsatisfying. There was no balm here that could soothe her spirit. The wilderness that had been fostered within her during her lawless life, the hunger for family, purpose, position, and money, all of these were left famished in the presence of these miserly old women and these miserable children. So pathetic, so pitiable, that she would sometimes mutter to herself as she was reminded of her charge to care for them, were not that God would have just killed them in their cradle. Yet, day in and day out, she would wash their clothes in a stream by the convent, and she would prepare their meals, cut vegetables, roots, and when, weather, and the pity of traveling merchants would allow it, perhaps honey and fig as dessert to have with crusty bread. And even as she worked and toiled, she noticed there was still some bounty in the land. After all, getting the milk of sheep and goats was of no great concern, and the merchants were doing well on the roads. Religious strife had seen their coffers grow as they decided which faction to choose and which to then double-cross their patron for. And so the land was bountiful at this time. So it was at this point, and it was odd then, that she found herself face to face with someone that she only knew to be an agent of the devil. At the stream, he appeared, cloaked in black feather, face pale and beautiful, as if cast in moonlight, though the nighttime sky she had just become aware of, as the sun had vacated its celestial vault and left both in darkness. He was the only source of illumination as the white world went black. With courtesy, he bowed to her. "Sister Alsatia, I am an angel and a messenger of your Lord, and I have come to make an offer on his behalf to you at the cost of your very soul. I say you this, abandon your post and these children, Alsatia. Abandon them, and I will provide you with all that the Lord has to give, beauty, fortune, all things eternal and splendorous shall be yours. You only need to agree to serve me. So what say you, Alsatia?" To this, Alsatia simply put down the rags that she had been wringing out, wiped the sweat from her brow, and then lifted a rock, prepared to throw it. Be gone from here. You're a fool. And I have been warned about devils, or at least men who pretend that they are. I have had a life of men who promise things to me, a life of splendor, like you call it. I came here for something to feed my soul. Foul imp. She then threw the rock, struck the feathered man in the head, and away he went into shadow until the light returned. And Alsatia, unsure of the repercussions of such things, returned to washing the clothes. The land is bountiful anyway, she said as she washed. I'll probably be here till I'm an old woman. There's enough wheat, there's enough cows, there's enough pigs, enough livestock, cheese, stupid old men having stupid young sons. This is a life sentence for me. Really couldn't get any worse than this. As she said those words and looked up towards the sun in its return sky, she noticed it seemed a bit dimmer than it had been prior. The year had just turned from 535 AD to 536. For those who are unaware of the significance of the year, 536 AD is said by many, though likely in a sensational manner, to be the worst year to be alive on record. The catastrophic natural disasters that occurred almost in sequence around that time led to a darkening of the sky and a chilling of the temperature, to such devastation, both in terms of agriculture and loss of human life, that it was likely that those who lived in such a time thought that they were looking at the very end of history. Rats were drawn to homes for warmth and food, and with them came plague. Crops failed, and with that came famine. And so too did death come in the form of starving men on the roads, desperate for anything to eat. And so, in a short period of time, her sisters, one by one, had fled. Some stayed, and many died. Medicine became hard to come by, food became quite scarce, and violence on the roads became intense. To even venture far enough from the convent to even begin to imagine going to another settlement town or any post was to welcome death into one's arms freely. Men were desperate. They would ride nuns down and execute them on the spot, strip them of their cloth, and either boil them in the hopes that they could make a meal or simply sell them. And those were the ones who did not resort to cannibalism outright. The winter had arrived in the ruins of the Metanoia. Fires had ravaged the structure, left it barely hospitable, hardly to be called shelter, though there were rooms still that had been repurposed from storage to living quarters. It was in those living quarters that Sister Alsatia, now much more gaunt, could be found with a sharpened stick hunting for rats. Any she found were a meal. Just as she was about to catch a particularly large one, she heard a cough, turned. The rat too heard it and fled. She cursed beneath her breath. A child rounded the corner. Sister Alsatia sighed. Barton, I told you to stay with the others. I'm trying to gather something to eat. Burton, the small child, practically a walking skeleton at this point, rubbed his eyes. Is it an apple, sister? Sister Alsatia, weary, eyes ringed red, lips cracked, smiled. Juicy apple, but go back by the fire. There may be another stack of scripture to burn. And once she returned with a string of four rats gathered round the burning scriptures with the children, eight in all. Were it not for the sister, these children wouldn't be here to even tell her that she had brought them perhaps the best meal that they could have ever hoped for. There was Rodinia, a small child who dreamt of being one day a model for sculptures. Barrett, a child who perhaps was a bit slow, but in time could learn to read if he had put his attention to it. Freshira, whose parents had come from far away, far from Byzantium, and who had died in the Hippodrome. She was now a stranger in a strange land. Gittle, supposedly the son of a famous pirate, left on shore like a discarded shell, meal plucked, free of pearls, nothing but trash. Dalsimir, who claimed his father to be a famous soldier, always would he say that he was quick with a blade, yet when the children played with sticks, when they had the energy, he was often in the middle of the pack for combatants. Small Rhodes, who had a hopeful future, his mother thought, as a musician for his beautiful voice, but now barely had the strength to talk above a whisper. And Silva, who dreamt of being a mother herself one day, in a small farm, perhaps somewhere distant and far away. To help her with this many children, she had but one older girl, Karina, a teenager at this point, and practically on the verge of womanhood according to the standards of the time. She said that she wished to be a nun with the sister. Of course, Sister Alsatia would talk her out of this constantly. With the children assembled, Sister Alsatia kept her back to them and hid away the view as she butchered the rats with a small flint knife. Still, the children tried to peek around and above to see the work. When one did catch a glimpse, they would scream as if they had seen a ghost. Gross, gross, Sister Alsatia. Sister Alsatia hissed. It's a meal that will keep us alive. Besides, it's better than paper and leather, isn't it? And so, with small shreds of meat, the children ate and survived yet another night. And as they fell asleep, Sister Alsatia read to them poems that talked of summer and warmth and light and the love of Jesus, his holy nature, all the while hiding the deep turmoil within her. For though she wore the cloth and though she had taken the vow, her faith was as fragile as their very lives. She had seen so many die, and so many desperate men do evil things. When she finally found sleep, then, she was torn from its comforts. By the cry of Karina. She ran as quickly as she could with bare feet across cold stone until at last she got to the source. Karina was in the arms of a masked man, a bandit.
Come on, girl. I may not have found a meal, but I know I found a wife. I don't know who left you in these ruins, but their loss is my gain. Come with me or I'll kill you.
Stone knife to neck. Karina screamed again, and this caused the bandit to strike her with the pommel of the knife. No attention could be given then as he struggled against the girl to the figure that lurched behind him. Karina shut her eyes as tightly as they could be shut and opened them again when she felt something warm pouring down over her shoulder. The bandit fell to the ground with a slashed throat, with the very same knife that she had used to butcher the rat. Alsatia stood above the corpse, helped Karina to her feet, and then told the girl something that chilled her, worse than the winter and the snow.
You are to tell no one of what has happened here, Karina. Not a soul will be told, or we will all die.
Karina, with shaky feet and legs that could buckle at any moment, nodded and ran off. Sister Alsatia looked the bandit over carefully.
I think a pig must have come to scavenge in the building. It scared Karina. Wild boar. It seems God has not abandoned us after all.
And with no reluctance and not an ounce of hesitation, she butchered the pig in the night. And it went on like that. At first, She would wait by the road outside. She would wear little more than her bathing garments. Knife hidden. Stance shaky until she caught the eye of a bandit again and again and again. And with great joy, she would tell the children, "I have found another pig in the wild. And this one looked fat, like it had been eating apples. So when we eat it, the Lord says that the body of such an animal is like an ark, a great boat carrying everything that they've eaten. Everything, children. Bread, honey. These pigs out here, they know how to even find cake and eat that too. So every piece you eat is a feast like you've never had before. Eat up, children. Eat up." And so the children laughed and the children ate. Until, in time, a holy man came to Metanoia. He had heard rumors that it was haunted. Pushing open the dusty doors, pushing aside the cobwebs, he entered the chamber with the burnt scriptures and found a sight that terrified him far too greatly to speak or even move. A woman in a room full of the remains of children, tiny skeletons huddled around a fire that had long gone cold, butchering a man with a knife and feeding strips of flesh through skeletal jaws like a lips. She turned to the priest with a bloody knife still in hand. "Another pig," and smiled. It would be 5 years before a serious inquiry would be made. For time after time, when anyone would come to investigate the Metanoia and what had really happened, there would be no reply. It took a small group of soldiers, accompanied by a bishop, to finally find, secure, and bring back the mad woman of the Metanoia, Sister Alsatia. And in that time, she had fed countless men, women, animals, anything she could, to the skeletons that were once the children in her care. In her madness and in her grief, she imagined them to be alive. She imagined them to be waiting for her. And yet, no one was. They had attempted exorcisms. They had attempted any intervention possible to get the information that they wanted from her, including torture. None of it seemed to get through. Until finally, after exhausting nearly every single option, they decided it would be best to simply give her poison in her sleep and, according to the records, simply say that the entire convent had gone mad, or perhaps that Sister Alsatia had killed them all, poisoned their meals. She would be an easy scapegoat after all, and there would be no shame brought to Theodora for her project. Her beliefs would remain intact, and the clergy would not receive any of the blow, socially, politically, anything. Certainly not financially, as there were plans for more metanoias in the future. As she was left alone in her cell, practically a walking skeleton, she found herself once again in darkness, where a familiar man appeared, still with a bleeding wound in the middle of his forehead, which he dabbed with his fingers. "Well, have you changed your mind, sister?" Sister Alsatia has no response. Madness, malnourishment, trauma, all of these things have gripped her spirit, leaving very little left of the once rebellious girl. The cloaked figure knelt beside her and then pulled a sheet up over her head. "There, there now. Perhaps a good night's rest will soothe you." And so she slept. And dreamt. And remembered. How they had died. The mushrooms. First, two of them dying that way. Finding wild mushrooms. Eating them, then killed by a wild animal, perhaps a wolf. Food becoming scarce. Then simple starvation. Then lack of food again, malnourishment. It was then small bits of wire and thread. All she would have to do to stay from eating their food as a martyr would, she would one by one stitch her lips shut. Then she could only drink soup made from leather and take care of the remaining children, thin, malnourished, desperate. With sewn lips, she drank soup, killed men, read burnt passages that were but scraps of word. But then, a miracle happened. When the cover was pulled from her face, the world was alive again. The children were there with her. She was just in her bed at the convent. Simply what it was. Everything was beautiful. Her soul was alight with joy. And the feathered man with the cloak helped her up from her bed. "There now, sister. I made a promise and I kept it. Will you be with me? I travel quite often and I could use a cook. Oh, I'm sure you're worried about your children. Well, they can come too, of course. Who else is supposed to take care of them but Sister Alsatia? Asatia, with cheeks that were just as full and blushing as when she had first joined the convent, laughed and cried both at once, and nodded her head, and said, "I had such a bad dream. It was a nightmare." The man covered in black feathers shook his head. "The difference between the dream and the nightmare, my dear, it's just a matter of when you wake up." And with that, Sister Alsatia and her children navigated through the world in the company of a magical black cloaked figure. From end to end they traveled, and it seemed as though days and weeks and years flew by. At every stop, she would tell the children of the history of the place whenever she could learn it. And they would laugh, and they would try to speak the local languages. But most of all, what they loved was the local food. It was the fruits and vegetables that enchanted them, and the meat when they could get it. She would pluck apples from trees and hand them to the children, and they would bite them and say, "That tastes like a Chinese apple to me. China. I've never even heard of that place before. Is it real?" Sister Alsatia would laugh and nod that it was and go on from there. And so everything went splendidly for her from then on and forever. The end. Mikey, you see a woman who is about 10 feet tall, perhaps 12, walking on a platform of titanic arms, scraping a knife across the ceiling that produces a spray of sparks with each step that she takes. But that's what you see. What she sees is a tree with apples swaying in the wind, where your head is, and hungry children hiding in the bushes, asking her to go and pluck it for them. You have, I would say, enough time with your molecular control to try and formulate a plan of action. Currently, you are trapped. You would need to pass a speed roll of 8 to get away from her tablecloth, we'll call it. Her stand, the Awakening, is spread out, covering the floor of this ruined apartment building you are in the Golgotha tenements.
Okay, so I had an idea, and I guess this seems like the perfect time to try it. I wanted to, I guess, initially try and create an advantage for myself with travelers.
Okay.
Specifically, when I was trying to think of what we could possibly do, you had made a comment of just like, you got to do the most JoJo shit, the most dumb, ridiculous nonsense that shouldn't work, but it does. And my brain came up with an idea late one night of the idea of like when you see, not necessarily like a magician, but you see somebody, you know, they set up a table with a nice like linen cloth, and then they put a bunch of plates and glasses and then all that other stuff, and they pull it off real quick without anything falling or breaking.
Okay.
Yeah, I want travelers to start spinning, and I'm going to wrap up that cloth and pull the same trick and pull us out from this pocket dimension without tripping us up.
So you want to send travelers below and start to pull up the cloth?
Yes.
Okay, give me a...
That's how I get out.
Go ahead and give me a gaze roll as you're attempting the maneuver. Yes, you are able to see this very quickly. The moment you're under the cloth, something seems to be moving very quickly at you from underneath it. Over the cloth, which you're standing on, you can see what looks like a shape, small childlike shape, running around underneath the cloth. So you can still attempt your maneuver, but you did see this ahead of time, and that gives you a boost if you'd like on whatever your next action is, you're prepared. The shape, like I said, child-sized.
Great. I'm just going to assume that's probably more hands at this point, as Mikey is unaware of the tragic backstory. I got to tie these blankets up. I know it's bad that her stand has now trapped me in a room. So I got to pull it for an opening.
Okay. Go ahead and give me a power roll. You have a +3 to the roll because you did succeed on your last roll with style. So now that you have like more of an intense understanding of the cloth, that gives you a 4. So that obviously is going to provide you with a little bit of a bonus, but may not be enough to completely wrap up the cloth or at least like pull enough away from it. So I'll let you decide. You see that this plan is basically going to take a little bit more time and a little bit more plan, like execution, to undo what she's done. How would you like to make the approach, I guess? Would you like to focus solely on that? Or are you going to try to focus on avoiding incoming danger?
Yeah, I guess I'm going to try and duck her and then just slide out through a crack in the cloth, or, you know.
Okay.
I don't have any bones. I can make myself as long and thin as possible to. No. I just need the tiniest amount of space.
The thing about it is, she is going to be able to see this, obviously.
Oh yeah.
She was coming towards you. She doesn't go for you though. She goes for actually, she's gonna vanish. That is an 8. She has a stop for it.
Does she just sink into the cloth?
Yeah, she just goes under herself and seems to be moving much more fluidly than perhaps you would be able to, even with your lack of bones. She's just under there swimming, more or less. You can attempt to roll against an 8 if you want, but it's rough. Actually, yeah, go ahead and give me a speed roll yourself. Jesus Christ. You have all your refresh, have refresh, so you have all your fate points back, but she's going to succeed with style.
Yeah, I'll pay one to reroll.
Okay.
Love to see it, folks.
No, you don't. Okay. You are, so as you're, it's just the sudden rush of movement from her, and the fact that this giant woman just disappeared in about, like, we'll say, the actual height of the cloth off the floor is less than an inch. Like, it's just flat against the floor. So the fact that she was able to just go under it like that is pretty fucking spooky. You have, I'll say, one turn before she executes on you. You wanted to just, like, get out, right?
Yeah.
Finding a crack in the floor is going to be a little bit difficult, especially when it's small enough for you to go through. Even though you are, like, no bones, you're not completely liquid.
Yeah, yeah.
I would say finding the actual crack is going to take you a turn. Depending on how well you do here, you may be able to at least, like, start to get through it before she just... Maybe, well, wherever the speed at that she was going at is pretty intense.
Okay. Yeah, I guess I will keep searching for a crack. I'm gonna keep trying to set myself up.
Okay. Go ahead and give me a wanderlust roll. see if travelers can, like, aid you in this. At the corner of the room, I would say with that roll, you may be able to find something resembling a crack that's large enough for you to get through quickly. Most importantly, quickly. The smaller it is, the slower you're going to go through it because you have to, like, squeeze your body down. Even with your molecular control, it's a little bit difficult to...
Yeah.
I would say your clearance is probably about 2 inches? Does that sound reasonable? Or do you feel like you could do... Okay. I mean, you're squeezing through with guns and whatever equipment you have on, too. So it's got to have... Otherwise, you're going to have to go through naked, I imagine. Not naked, but unarmed. Are you still under the cloth is a question as well?
I mean, I think that Travelers definitely is. I don't know if he is. I think I feel like he would be on top of the cloth trying to pull it up. Sort of like a fitted sheet situation. He's trying to get it up and then tuck himself under.
Okay. So are you just gonna book it? How are you gonna make it across there? So you don't see her. How do you like want to try to? Is it just pure instinct, pedal to the metal?
Yeah. I think he's gonna just do like a little pop, like. He's just going to kick up as quick as he can, not touching the floor, just as fast as he can fly in into whatever space he can find.
All right. So as you are going through trying to get to this crack, you can feel a flap. Like a flap of the material behind you, like a sharp snap sound. Rising up as if breaching the water, Alsatia arcs through the air down towards you with her fork held with both hands, like a trident. This comes with a plus one on top of it. That is an 11. As she's doing this, you can see a sort of roiling arms and limbs beneath her cloth are beginning to pull at her own flesh. She gains a consequence from doing this. Currently, her stand has begun to consume herself because she put that much power into the stabbing motion. You're gonna have to, at this point, I don't know what you want to roll for this. Probably speed? Or is it running? Yeah, go ahead and give me a speed roll. A 5? Do you want to boost that in any way, or are you just gonna let it roll?
No, I'll boost it to make it a 7.
Okay. In that case, you take, 4 physical stress, but because she was able to get such a super advantage on you from her speed roll, that turns that 10, or that 11 rather, into a 14. And you take 7 incoming stress. You still have, I assume, you don't have any consequences, right?
No. I had a mild one last session.
That's clear then at the beginning of this fight.
Yeah.
But you would then just take 1 physical stress and 1 mild consequence.
Yep.
As you are pinned to the floor. You can sort of see blood beginning to stain the white of her sheet, and it's not yours.
Oh, great.
Next action is yours, though. What would you like to do? You're currently pinned to the floor with a giant, like, fork.
I think I gotta get myself out from under the pin. I guess could I just kind of slide around it or use my molecular control to sort of, like, break myself up?
Unpin yourself from this. Normally you could. This fork is not normal, though. You can tell it's supernatural in nature, it's gonna definitely hold you there.
Okay, then I guess I gotta get her off me, so I will shoot her.
Okay, you're gonna just fire with your gun?
Yeah, I mean, she's right there.
Okay, go for it. Fire off a shot, I guess good eye sniper roll. She is point blank. Four. See how she does. Unless you invoke, her knife just swings up and blocks the shot, right point blank. She's not just strong at this range, she's also fast as her stand is consuming her body and using it for fuel.
Though
not for long.
Yeah, I'll pay fate point.
Okay, you want to turn that into...
I'll turn it into a six.
A six? Okay. She takes...
I'm not going to roll.
Okay, that's... Yeah, fair enough. It's really risky tonight. She takes one stress, but it does push her off of you. Do you want to, now that you're free of her, do you want to try to get out through that crack again?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. You're going to have to roll speed versus speed. A four versus a four, that's a tie. Yeah, I figured. So, at this point, just as you're about to get to the crack, that same knife that she used to deflect the bullet crashes down in front of it before you can get out. And not only that, she bunches the cloth up with one of her hand feet towards the crack, completely pushing it in, and then looks at you, sharpening her knife against her fork again. In her mind, the children are saying, "Yay! Sister Alsatia's great at catching rats. They never get away. Not ever." In reality, you just see a bleeding monster with way too many limbs, holding an enormous knife and fork, kind of leaning over you and heavily breathing, pushing forward the cloth as she prepares to once again make you her prey. You are now, for all intents and purposes, actually trapped. You're in a tight corner with a very strong melee combatant. You are a long-ranged weapon user. You've already taken pretty serious hit, though you're not pinned anymore. You're definitely perforated, and it hurts. It's not like normal damage. This isn't like bullets. This is a spiritual weapon, we'll call it. So now things are looking very bad for you. What would you like to do? Do you feel like you need some time?
Possibly.
Well, in that case, that's great, because we're going to zip right over to another scenario. That's how I'm going to try to balance this out. I'll give you some time to try to come up with something cool. We'll get back, and you haven't thought of anything. I'll try to help you out with whatever ideas you could use, but otherwise, you have a problem, you're stuck in a corner, see what happens. Who wants to be next? Should we go to Claudia or should we go to Enya? Ice Peak, you are currently on the street. We have action for you too, don't worry, because wherever your head landed, probably not far away from the mob.
I figured as this is all happening at once, I would be near last.
Yeah, we'll see. So which, Claudia or Enya, which one of you feels a little bit more prepared here?
How are you feeling, Claudia?
I'm still kind of a little thinking a little bit, but doesn't really matter to me too much.
All right. In that case, we move on over to Claudia and Rhesus in a completely blacked out basement. Claudia, you're basically in an arena of flies that have been born from Rhesus' negative stand, World Eater. these drones that can convert other humanoids into drones just like them. The spines coming from the body of the stand user or his enormous king fly. Currently, he has you impaled on the spear being held from his king fly's mouth by two human-sized arms just emergent from this thing's head. What would you like to do?
What's the spear made out of?
It's like some kind of weird black shell-like material, like a chitin.
Okay, so I imagine, what she would probably do is, using kind of, her mode of Opa and Oyster, kind of like superheat both of her arms and try to sever the spear.
Okay.
By just slamming into it and trying to just melt it away.
Give me a power roll.
Okay.
Just straight up.
Okay.
Oh boy. Oh boy. Do you want to roll again? Do you want to make an invoke?
Why did that roll? I didn't even click that.
We'll just treat that as a 3 then. If you meant to roll durability, the result would have been a 3, I think. So a 3 versus a 5 means you would not break the spear, or you could succeed with a complication.
I'll succeed with a complication.
All right, you managed to break the spear off, but the hook tip of the thing, this was meant to sink into flesh and stay put. And because you're focusing your molecular control currently on your arms, it will be very hard to dig this thing out without causing more organ and flesh damage to yourself. So you will basically be able to break the spear so you can't cause further damage, but half of it's still stuck in you.
Okay.
With that happening, the fly, king fly, your sonar is still going, right?
Yeah.
The king fly will actually let go of its broken half of spear and go behind Rhesus, crunch its body down a bit, extend its abdomen out, and Rhesus will very carefully lean back, feel around, and then sit down in what is basically a living insectoid throne. He takes a deep breath, which you can hear, and then exhales. Oh, well, that's not bad. Go ahead and give me a gaze roll against a 0. You know what? I'm gonna have him invoke. He is a plague bringer. There we go, 4. You're gonna need to roll a gaze against 4. Because as he's sitting, Jesus Christ. Well, what happens here at this point is your sonar goes out. The beating of the flies, once he takes his throne, that their wings become so intense that it starts to nullify all other sounds. They are drowning out all sounds. This is a stunt that he has. I will copy and paste it for you. Means that right now there's currently a scene aspect here, all consuming drone. This will obviously mess with your ability to sonar track. You have an action if you would like to take it now. So currently, you're blind technically because it's pitch black, and you are now deaf like he is. You do have fire, though, actually, now that I think about it. You got those burning arms. How hot do they get? Body?
I don't know how hot they can get, because they are the Opa are the only deep sea fish that still have warm bodies.
Hmm. It's probably pretty warm, maybe enough to not like blue levels of like pyromancy, but you may be able to like start a fire with combined with your like your hard stones that you produce off your body and your like hot hands. I mean, you gotta be able to, you could at least start like a campfire that way easily, I'd say. Right? Mm. Makes sense?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay. Well, you're in the darkness, so. Yes, what would you like to do here, basically? You're in the darkness, you have part of a spear through you. This guy's just taken the throne of all flies and is now attempting to ascend with your body as part of his monuments. What would you like to do?
She will start kind of creating small little fires around the area that will kind of get a better view of how everything proceeding and kind of see where those other devices of his are.
We'll say for the purposes of their locations, it's pretty hard to tell with just the amount of fire that you've made. It's also not a very strong fire, but it's enough to light up the position. You can see there are several flies that have already begun to angle themselves towards you, like the drones that they are. And you can also see the silhouette of Rhesus kind of receding into further darkness back away from you. So you can see that there's basically an incoming attack. There may be locations where the other devices are, but more pressing is the incoming drones.
Right.
What would you like to like poise yourself here for? Because they are going to lunge at you any moment.
I think what she'll do is she'll position herself near to a wall as she can.
Okay. What's your plan against the wall? Just to get something against your back?
Oh, the plan kind of is to wait right until the last moment of when an attack is coming and then sort of duck out of the way so that instead of hitting her, it hits the wall, basically.
Okay. Let's see. As you press against the wall, go ahead and give me a 1d2 roll.
Okay.
You're pressing against the wall has alerted you that you have a spine of World Eater inside of your body, aside from the spear. This spine is going to speed up the metamorphosis of you becoming one of his drones. You have time before that happens, but you have been stuck. And if you're stuck more times, it's going to speed up.
Right.
I would say you're familiar enough now with him that anytime you make physical contact with him and his drones, they have a chance to leave a spine in you. You can undo that if you want. You can literally re-roll that with a refresh if you need to. But otherwise, we'll say you're on step, I don't know, 2 out of 5 right now, because you've been stuck before. If you get stuck 3 more times, the metamorphosis will occur.
Okay.
With that in mind, he is going to send his drones directly to speed at you. You're going to need to roll speed against speed. Oh my god.
Okay.
Speed against speed.
Alright.
Three.
Yeah, I mean, I can't really...
Got any invokes?
I mean, I got invokes, but I'm not sure I'm going to be able to get even close to a six, even on a reroll.
If you have two fate points left, right?
Yep.
If you use them both, you'll be able to get away from that. If not, you're going to be flipping another coin.
Yeah, I'll go ahead and invoke to beat that.
Okay. What do you invoke?
Going to invoke her depth and her secret sniffer, basically.
Okay. How is your secret sniffer going to help you here? I can depth. You have like light, and maybe that gives you a little bit of an edge. But what is your what secret are you sniffing out?
I guess kind of how they're moving, because I imagine it's really dark. It's actually really dark still, even with a little flame. So I imagine she can't exactly see how it's moving. In the darkness, and that's kind of how I imagined a little bit of sniffing out how exactly its movement is working.
Okay. So as you're focused on this thing coming at you, because of Rhesus Negative's all-consuming drone, you don't hear the one coming up from beneath you at an angle. The ones in front were a distraction. The ones coming at you from below are the real attack that puts his score at a +2. He's invoking the scene aspect he created. You get hit for two physical stress? Seven? One physical stress. You get hit for one. But you do get an idea of how the flies do attack. The ones that were moving towards you were doing it with an attack motion. They kind of like almost lightning bolt zigzag through the air. They go down hard, cut left or right real fast, and then zip in at an angle to try and duck any defenses you might be putting up, like your arms or a shield or anything. You still take a hit, but you do gain the knowledge that will provide you with a bonus to a roll incoming. Speaking of which, roll me another 1d2.
All right.
You manage to stave off the metamorphosis, but you can feel yourself slowing down a little. Though it is not advancing from contact with the drone of World Eater, your vision gets a little blurry now. And I would say it's pretty clear to you that this guy fully intends to kill you, and not just you, but everyone that you know and love, and your children, and anyone that could potentially ever have been influenced by you. The ferocity, the consuming nature of these flies, this man's hatred is boundless. He doesn't just want to see you destroyed, he wants to see anything related to the name Claudia Cornell destroyed. But most of all, perhaps, your thoughts go to your children. Innocent, just wanting a simple, normal life, wanting a chance at life in Guam or just in this world. Monsters like this man, they'll tear him to pieces and then make up a reason why they had to do it. Nathaniel Furneaux was a serial killer. He was a murderer outright. He killed a friend and colleague of yours, one of your squad mates, and who knows how many civilians. And this man before you, Rhesus Negative, is mourning him with violence and yet more atrocities. So right now you have a sort of decision that you can make. You can stay on the defensive and hope that you'll outpace this man's hatred, this bonfire of ruin and decay that he's trapped you here with in this basement. Or you can take him out. Or, and really far-fetched, you could try to reason with him, but he does not seem very reasonable at all. What is Claudia's general approach going to be going forward?
She's probably going to take him out, I think.
Okay. Go ahead and make another... what is your next move here? It's now your turn.
I imagine at this point she's going to, after being hit like that, she's going to try to further enhance the trap she laid earlier by grabbing as many devices as she can and kind of trying to tune them so whenever a trap does go off, it goes off pretty much like enhanced.
Okay. You're gonna have to, for that, give me a precision roll, I think.
All right.
So remind me again, the trap is just to, what did you want to do with the trap here? What was the general setup?
The general setup was her stones laid out in very key parts that he isn't aware of, and then with the devices tuning them so that basically the frequency and vibration would be that much more enhanced by further sounds kind of bouncing off, and it basically making the entire area here a giant sound bomb.
All right.
Okay.
It happens the first time that you get near a device that a drone simply impales it before you get there. And then it happens a second time. This really could be no coincidence. He's actually taking them out before you get your hands on them. And not only that, the flies that took out those devices are keyed into a position to all make a triple strike at you from all different angles. They seem prepared to do so.
Okay.
He is going to execute that on you. Let's see. Well, that comes at a 5. Go ahead and roll speed roll. He's undone like your attempt at the plan to use the devices. It does not undo your plan with the rocks before. Do you have any fate points left?
No, okay. I do not.
All right. In that case, he is going to... let's see. What is he at? Oh, Jesus Christ. Okay. In that case, give me a 1d2 roll. Again.
Okay.
One of them strikes you on the side. You take one physical stress and you can feel the transformation is now at level 3. Two more and you are taken out.
Okay.
You're officially trapped with no devices left. You still have your stones in place. It is your turn. What would you like to do?
Without any devices, she's going to... I guess, are there bodies still in this place?
Yeah, there's still some rotting corpses in this basement. Probably local homeless who had been sheltering here, squatting in this building.
Hmm. Okay. Then it's a little morbid, but she's going to probably go for one of those and actually grab it as a shield and start trying to figure out where he is to make a final, to make a strike at him. Probably, yeah, she's probably going to use it as a shield and then start just firing off bullets of pearl bullets around to figure out exactly where he is.
Okay. Go ahead and give me a, with this, I would say, give me a power roll, I think. If you're just firing off bullets and holding up a body as a shield.
Yes.
Okay. Four. Also a four. Okay, no consequence of that. So you're able to get sort of a general idea of where he is with your the remaining fires, but he is... And your body shield does block a few flies from incoming, just stabbing you again from those two other angles. However, you get a general idea of where his silhouette is, thanks to the fires that you lit earlier, I would say. So you have like an approximation what direction he's in.
All right.
He is going to... Yeah. I would say that succeeds. He actually uses his turn to create an advantage by extinguishing your fire. The drones kind of dive bomb the places that are on fire. You can actually hear them sizzle and burn, and you can smell their burning insectoid matter as they just body slam right into them, taking them out.
All right.
You're once again in darkness, but you have a general idea of where he is. What would you like to do here? It's your turn again.
All right.
Yeah. If I speak for her, she'd probably have an easier time, I guess, with the dead bodies and electricity.
Dead bodies, electricity, and I can smell people. My sense of smell is better because I'm from the Twilight area.
You know, all you'd smell here are dead bodies and gross gore, but yeah, you might be able to smell them because of all the snack food he eats.
Actually, she's just going to start lighting the bodies on fire.
Including the one you're holding?
Yes.
Yes!
Jesus. All right, go ahead and give me a... what do you even roll for this? Give me a precision roll, I suppose. Secret sniffer.
All right. No, come on.
A one. No, it's still something. I mean, you still get light off of that for sure. It just doesn't catch him so unaware that it would create an advantage. Instead, the sudden warmth causes him to shield his face slightly, though he can't see it. His blind eyes look into all directions. You do see him now, though, with that amount of fire. With that movement, however, the drones are definitely going to move in on you. They're attempting to create an advantage by aligning themselves in a strike formation. With a speed roll, you'll be able to like quickly move out of the potential strike vectors before they launch their attack. So go ahead and give me a speed roll, I guess, against his roll to create advantage. Damn.
The one time, okay.
Yeah, you managed to weave so well that you actually get behind where his throne is, giving you an advantage on him. It's actually a super advantage. You get a plus three to your next roll. You have the, Yeah, you have, you, it is your turn and you have a plus three to your roll. What would you like to do?
Okay.
Let's see. I think what she'll do is she will take the burning, one of the burning bodies gathered up, and it's a little fucked up, but actually just try to set his throne on fire.
You want to try to burn his throne? Okay.
Yes.
Go ahead and give me a, this is going to be a speed roll.
All right. Oh, come on.
That's still a four. You managed to ignite part of his throne, causing part of him to actually set on fire. His left side of his body. He begins to... Actually, no, he doesn't panic. He just kind of sits there on fire. Leans back into his throne. And then you watch as he opens his mouth, unrolls his tongue, and starts to let down this deluge of very weird, slick, slightly yellowed saliva onto his arm, extinguishing it. He is going to cause his drones to strike out at you now that he knows precisely where you are. You will need to roll either speed or durability, whatever your choice is. You can either use your body shield, your burning body shield, to block incoming attack, or you can just try to outrun them. What would you like to do here?
I guess try to use the body shield.
All right, give me a durability roll.
Okay, cool.
Fucking... All right, you take four incoming stress. I need you to roll another 1d2 as they strike you down. Transformation is staved off for now. However, actually, you take, I'm sorry, not four stress, you take three stress.
No, okay.
Because he's converting that into a boost. He pays one stress, he converts it into a boost, plus two. You are further feeling slowed down and sluggish by the body metamorphosis. What is your next action here?
She'll start moving around and then actually start kind of talking like... You know what? Inferno was fucking pathetic. He died crying and weeping in his grave, and so will you. You'll meet him just the same. Not only that, but you look so pathetic trying to be a king among corpses. I know he can't hear me, but that's the gist.
Give me a gaze roll.
Okay.
Something's weird about his body as you're talking to it. You're not quite sure what. Strange shape? Perhaps that's not your action. Are you trying to create an advantage?
Yeah, kind of trying to. Yes.
Go ahead and give me a power roll for that, I suppose.
All right.
Three.
Three is not horrible, at least.
Yeah. Let's see how he does. Yep. It seems like his body actually pauses, or the throne actually stops moving. It is now his turn. For the sake of whether or not you can see what's happening as it's happening, go ahead and give me a speed roll real quick. This is just to tell if you're quick enough.
That's it.
This comes with a plus two, so a four versus a two. You're not fast enough. Right about as around the time you finish taunting him, you realize something very, very wrong. The body in the throne is just a whole pile of these drones stacked in his clothes. He emerges from the corpse pile behind you with a fistful of those stickers all clenched into a bundle and begins to rapidly stab you with them, reaching around your neck and just stabbing into your chest like a prison shank repeatedly.
Okay.
Give me a 1d2 roll.
Okay.
A two. You manage again to stave off metamorphosis, but you do take two physical stress from that attack. He's now within close range of you and naked. You can sort of see him, I suppose, in the fire. This man is like pale. He practically has translucent skin. He looks like he doesn't go out into the sun very often, if at all. Also, he does not look even the slightest bit afraid to be this close to you with his just bare body and these very primitive needles. What would you like to do now that he's this range?
Okay. she's actually going to try to turn around and just bloody him as much as possible.
Sure. Go for, I guess, a power roll here.
No, right?
Just trying to body him real quick. Oh, a six. Versus a two. I'm gonna let that roll. Okay, so where do you hit him, basically?
I think she just starts hitting him, like, probably around the ribs.
Okay.
Where the ribs would be.
Right. Go ahead and roll a 1d2. But you do hit him. I believe that's a four incoming stress. So he's got cracked ribs. He stumbles backwards. His breathing is ragged. He doesn't seem to be afraid of you, I'll say. Even if you punched him with superhuman force, and it definitely was enough to crack his ribs. But he doesn't seem like he's the slightest bit afraid. If anything, once you actually catch a look on his face, he looks excited about this. With that, he actually will send his flies to further extinguish the flames around the room, putting out any bodies that they can. See if he can. Yeah, that's total darkness again. It's a five. So he puts the room into total darkness, and there's just droning. rapid droning. You can hear small clicks and kind of wet sounds happening in the direction that you saw him kind of walking backwards into. Sounds like almost a slurp sound. You can hear what sounds like, it sounds like somebody cracking open a watermelon. Like that kind of like that kind of crack of flesh. But you are once again in darkness and in the drone-laden kind of like buzz that just drowns out all other sound.
Oh, good.
Before you make your next action, you can hear a voice now. Each time the voice speaks, you can hear almost like it sounds like a, yeah, like an eggshell cracking underneath it.
Oh.
There is a flicker of one of the last remaining embers of light that you see in the basement. And what you see is the naked... the naked rhesus negative sliding, well, discarded on the ground is the original head and face of his king drone, and sliding into its neck, naked and covered in goop, is rhesus negative, kind of crawling inside of his own stand. And you can see his mouth beginning to split a little bit like a mandible as he's talking, Detective Cormac. He is assuming a new form.
Oh, good.
And then the light goes out entirely again. That is what's happening with Claudia.
We have this all under control.
Now let's get to... Let's get to Enya, I guess.
It's my turn.
Okay, Enya.
I'm naked and slurped up.
You are dealing with Father John, congregants, and a burning truck full of drugs, highly deadly chemical agents behind you. What would you like to do, buddy?
My God, just all the chaos. Let's see. Well, she's gonna have to attack hard and fast because, you know, got things to deal with here. So, is there any chance? I mean, she did just come up from out of the sewers, right?
Yeah.
There's bound to be a fire hydrant nearby, right?
I'd say so. Sure.
Yeah. Can she just like kick that shit open and like just have the water gush out?
Sure, you're trying to create a scene aspect then?
Okay, this is ridiculous, but you know how, like, the one time she did, like, the concentrating the fuel basically into, like, a jet pressure?
Sure, yeah.
Yeah, any chance she could use that to, like, give herself a boost up into the air, like, basically, like, ride it up?
Yes. Okay, that's fine. You want to ride the wave of water from a broken hydrant with like liquid light coating your feet or something?
Yeah, like just doing like a sort of a pulse thing, like a controlled thing.
Okay, sure. I'll allow it.
But if the stream is still there, is there any chance she can continue to use that to basically have like a giant sword swing at this guy?
Oh.
Okay. You want to come down at him with a, an enormous sword swing. That's going to first take you. You're going to have to roll power first to break that hydrant.
Okay.
I mean, you still break it, obviously. It just doesn't give you the advantage. So he's gonna see that and just roll his, A two. As he welcomes his gatherers to step in front of him, and he steps backwards.
Oh, really?
You can still go for the sword swing, but you'll have to go through these people for it.
Is this a precision roll, then?
Yep. Four. You cut through the people in front of you, in front of him. He is unscathed. Completely.
Can the sword swing go down and break the ground in front of him then?
Sure.
Alright, I want to break that pavement.
Pavement cracks. There are two people who are like cut down by your sword, though. The rest of the crowd is starting to panic, of course, because the giant bright angel who just proclaimed that he was a false prophet and all that just killed two of them with a magical light sword.
Shit.
What is your next move here?
Can she land like on that spot, like in front of him? And basically just like try to grab at him. Basically I want to clash him next.
Sure. You can land right in front of him and clash him. Go ahead and roll clash. You don't have to pay a fate point for this because each one of your blows just goes right beside him and around him. He takes one palm, presses it into your chest, and sends you back roughly 20 feet. Like your feet are gonna slide along the ground, but it's like you got hit by a truck.
Ah, this is familiar.
He's then going to wave his hands over the people that you just killed, and from their body rises two origami birds, one for each. Each one holding a scroll in its beak. You can see that written on the scroll is severed and cut down by sword. Once the birds leave, the wounds begin to mend on those people and life comes back to them. They wake up screaming. Father John gently lifts his hand and plucks the scrolls from the origami birds and then just holds them up towards you, Enya.
You're still thinking like some kind of caveman or something. You're not dealing with ordinary thugs that you can just cut down. This is a miracle. Holy power, divinity. Do you think you can just use your sword to solve every problem there, detective?
He crushes the paper in his hands.
That's foolish.
Stop using civilians as shields.
Stop resisting, officer. Isn't that something you're used to saying to people?
I don't understand why these people are even listening to you. All you have is just lies. 7 times of lies. Multiplied by 7, just... I don't understand.
What's there not to understand? Think about it carefully, if you will. People like you can just regenerate whenever you're hurt. When you're cut down by a sword, your flesh will just knit itself back together in one piece. You'll be able to walk away, not a scratch on you eventually. But these men and women, when they're cut down by swords, there's nothing that's gonna save them, outside of modern medicine occasionally if they get there fast enough. It takes real holy power, divine power, to make them whole again. You are walking, talking contradiction. You're worried about how fragile these people are, but your entire species was made to kill them. And on top of that, you'll likely survive much longer than they will in the most harsh conditions. I bet mermen could even travel to space without much problem. Humans need suits and rocket ships and all sorts of radioactive protection. These people are delicate, protective. And delicate things, they require protection. And it can't come from someone like you, a wolf dressed up as a sheep. It has to come from a true shepherd, a man who wants to take charge of the flock. They'll do exactly what I tell them. And there's nothing you can do about it, because that's how free will works. Now, congregation, this false angel has lied and attempted to turn your hearts against me. I think it's time for you to take up arms and strike her down.
The people, scared at what they'd seen, are also frightened. Could they next be the victim of a sword slash from this strange cop? Who knows? Either way, with a 4, Father John is attempting to turn the crowd against you. Wouldn't even be hard. He's gonna get a +2 to that roll just because they saw 2 of you cut 2 of them down. You have a few options here. You may have to face the incoming violence of these just regular ass humans. Or you could try to turn them against Father John. You are a coordinator.
I am. How many people are in front of him right now?
He's got about a crowd of, right now, after you cut those 2 people down, they probably scattered a little, so he's got like 5 people currently.
Outspeech this guy.
Yeah, it seems direct attacks are going to be difficult unless you can figure out whatever the weakness of his stand is.
He does need to make those little paper things.
Papers and screens do seem to be part of the functionality, the mechanics, but there's nothing that says breaking a screen actually stops what he's doing. In fact, he told you that it wouldn't. And it's possible he could also use a fractured screen as different separate screens. I'll tell you the way that you've seen his stand operate is that the screens play out an outcome. When they are playing an outcome, those outcomes do not occur. And his birds can lift outcomes out of screens and then help him to narrow down one inevitable outcome. In the case of Shaka Khan, the outcome was him getting bodied, which is why it happened. So it seems like his screens all have outcomes playing on them. He's manipulating that by choosing the right outcome. The ones that are displayed are outcomes that will not occur. In other words, he's removing all numbers from a set except for the one he wants.
I just have to keep those birds from landing, it seems like.
Seemingly extremely difficult, though you've seen some of them land. Some of them have not landed on a screen, and the screen has just played out the scene, so... Birds just seem to be part of a transportation mechanic. They may not necessarily be the entirety of the stand's effects. But you do know that your liquid light could potentially interfere with some of this. Light seems to be part of it.
Are people still struggling from the green crack? Or are they all just kind of ignoring that?
Oh, they're going too soon. I mean, they're not... People aren't, like... It hasn't gone off yet. Like, the actual explosion. Thing's still burning, but the interior has not detonated yet. So you got, like, some time... Not a lot, but some time before the fire reaches the inside and starts burning the drugs.
Okay. Okay. I'm gonna make an attempt to negotiate that.
Okay.
All of you, look. I serve me and my team. Serve Guan. This is an outsider, and he doesn't serve who he claims. He actually... This is ridiculous. He serves the Antichrist, alright? And I know that sounds ridiculous, but... What reason would I have to lie to you all? I'm your police force. I've done nothing but serve this city. Surely some of you have, like, seen me around. I run the House of the Rising Sun. I'm one of you all.
Okay, give me a breakthrough roll. A 6? Very good. See if he can get past that. He cannot. Yes, one good roll. People, some of them are starting to become swayed and break a bit free from Father John's words. He doesn't seem too flapped by this. He just kind of pushes his sunglasses up. Well, that was a mighty fine speech.
Speech my ass. I'm just talking plain.
Just talking plain. Why don't you tell the good people here what you were doing in Russia exactly? Why were you there, detective? Since you hate the Antichrist so much. Care to tell them, to illuminate them on what might have occurred there?
I can't do that in a court of law. This isn't really the place. There's a bit of a pressing time bomb issue behind us.
Court of law. This is a court of God. Now, your lies and mistruths may help serve you in the manipulation of these people, but this woman who says that she is so adamantly against the will of the Antichrist helped to give rise to the New World Order. She assisted in the assassination plot of the president of the Seven Nation Army. And in the power void that occurred, the vacuum, the New World Order rose, having waited so long to spring its trap. She willfully, gleefully, insistently was actually my partner in helping the end of days get closer still. And now she stands before me, having found a voice and two legs to stand upon and a violent sword to swing.
What's your point? And also, if that were the case, why am I betraying you now? What change of heart happened?
Oh, isn't it obvious? Pure, total power. He throws his hands to the air. She wants to be queen of this ruined world. Her and all her kind want to just reign over it. They want to hunt you and your children through the streets that are going to be flooded so that they can swim faster than you can run in the high water. And once you're swept out to the ocean, her and her terrible, aquatic, demonic cohort will tear you to pieces. They'll take great joy in rending fat, blood, organs, and viscera from your form and bathe themselves in your gore, as they have been told to do so by the terrible devil lord of the deep, Avicii. And he has said that they will celebrate in your very guts.
Alright, look, if all of you are afraid of me, that works too. I would actually appreciate if you all cleared the area, alright? Also, can she just start rolling this truck at him?
It's really heavy, man.
Yeah, she can change form and just start, like, trying to shove it towards this guy. Like, obviously it won't be very fast.
It's not going to be very fast, sure. But the closer you're going to get, closer you push it to him, the closer you're going to push it to his congregation. Yeah, you will kill all the people if you do this. I mean, you could just choose to kill all the people. That takes care of the problem.
Oh my god. No, obviously she can't do that. What do? What are you... To what end? What are you doing? Why make this... giant hostage situation?
Oh, you mean, what is the effort being expended upon? Like, why bother, you're asking? It's pretty simple. The longer I keep you distracted, the easier it'll be for my people to find that Cortland Kingswood without much trouble. You and your Aqua unit are a bit of a pain in the ass, always finding little ways to twist fate and find your little source of good and light in the world, quote-unquote, whatever bullshit you tell yourselves. But why keep you pinned down here? You're not out there. And you can't help any of the others either, because you know they're in a whole shitload of trouble, trust me. That Detective Cornell, she's probably run afoul of sweet little Reese's. And I have to imagine your friend De La Cruz, the one that's made of vegetables, is going to be a nice side dish for one of Alsatia's great grand buffets. What I'm saying here is every one of you is fucked. Divinely fucked. The longer I keep you here, the easier it'll be for the rabble to find that boy for me, and I'll have $10 million to give them when they're done. Easy work for... And man of God, don't you think? He starts fanning himself with one of his origami birds that he's converted into a fan.
Okay. While he's talking, can she just start, like, stomping on the ground that, like, she cracked into earlier to get it to, like, break and just expose, like, the sewers below?
Sure.
Alright, she's gonna start grabbing people and throwing them into the water.
Oh, Jesus, you're just throwing people down into the sewers.
Yeah, they're just brainwashed and she can't help them now.
You just cracked the ground beneath, yeah. What?
Go.
What?
I'm there. I can literally be a hose.
A hose?
Yes, I can turn my body into a hose and plug myself into the water source.
You can.
That's freaking ridiculous. All right, yeah, when Andy catches on that, like, you're offering to do that, she's just gonna start hosing people in.
No, the burning truck, man.
You could literally just watch the truck.
What, get rid of the truck?
Put out the fire. She's saying you should put out the fire on the truck.
Oh, that's way more reasonable.
Okay. No, put them all in the sewers. You are all trash now. Into the sewers you go.
There's no fumes down there. They're only stinky fumes.
I mean, they won't like it, but... I will probably save them from the green crack truck.
Maybe.
Okay, DM, can I use a hose to get rid of the fire?
You can.
What?
Go ahead and give me a gaze roll.
Great, one of my worst stats.
Three. No, that's good.
Phew.
What's up? Or we, what?
Oh no, that's just a very high roll for her, for a gaze roll.
It is.
I was proud.
Gaze and speed, man.
Okay.
I might invoke if that's a block to it.
Oh, it's not a block. He's not trying to block you.
Oh.
You can invoke if you want to see what he's about to do before he does it.
Ew. I'm just gonna hang on to them.
Okay. You managed to extinguish the flames. You put them out with the ice peak hose that you used. And as you are about to feel job well done, you feel the force of four fists punching you in the back with the force of like an incoming freight train, causing you to fly forward into the truck that you just extinguished, through the metal, into the green crack.
Oh.
You crash through the material, barrel through the other side, and you are covered in cracked green crystals, fumes, and various chemicals that are getting into your wounds by the time you unroll from that damage.
Dope.
You have a consequence right now. You have been, we'll say, intoxicated, mild consequence. The green crack is going to start working its way through your system. Father John, on the other side of this busted truck, kind of just brushes his fingernails across his shirt, breathes on them, and then smiles, one of his winning smiles. Guess we're about to have a real party here, huh, Detective? See, you can't use violence to get your way, but pure comedy says that I sure can. That's how it works in the Bible, after all. He starts to walk forward towards you. He lifts himself over the truck, floating in the air, and then gently lands on the other side, facing you. You see, God did a lot of smiting, but you ever notice nobody really tried to smite him back? Not because they didn't want to, they just couldn't do it. Likewise, pure comedy keeps you from retaliating in any way. I am effectively invincible. So if you'd like to apologize before the drugs start really working their way through your system, I could probably save you, of course, just like I did back in Vladivostok. Or you could continue to be impudent and try to rise up against me with your weird mentality and morality thing going on. It doesn't matter to me, but I could always use another little bit of muscle around the church. He smiles. What do you think?
She's just gonna, like, basically puke liquid into her hands. And basically try to wash herself off.
I mean, you can definitely try to get some of this stuff off, but it is already working its way through your system. Your level of molecular control is the only reason it's not currently just causing you to have a seizure. That and combined with your physiology being kind of used to, adapted to liquid like its various forms, like you're subconsciously, I would say, right? Like your body is probably fighting off the effects, but it's a lot. This is like getting a dose of like, it's like rolling around in a bunch of meth crystals with cuts all over your body. I mean, it's not going to be fun. It's going to be bad. You're getting fentanyl kind of like poured into your open wounds and kind of blown into your face.
Okay. Can she collect any of it with like...
Yeah, there's likely enough on you to, like, gather up.
Well, let's try throwing it at this dude, since he's so close.
Okay. Gather some up and throw it at him. There's no roll necessary, it just goes all around him, doesn't hit him at all. He just kind of looks at you with a quizzical stare. Is that really the best you can muster? I've seen monkeys fight with more maneuvers than that. Practically throwing your feces at me. Disgusting. He brushes his coat, like one stray crystal off of his coat. He just flicks it away with his nail. Anything else up your sleeve, bright eyes, or is it pretty much game over?
Just was trying to take you to the highest high with me.
I'm already as high as it gets. I'm in heaven right now. If I could have told myself back then how much power I'd have now, I think I would have held on a little bit longer in the dark. Or maybe I would have just let go that much quicker. The rush, the absolute control that pure comedy gives me. It's incredible. Leroy. I could even kill Leroy with this power. And I will if he gets in my way. I don't care what his plans are. My plans are to take us back to the 20th century. My plan is to undo all this terrible, terrible destruction. My plan is to just live again on a nice porch somewhere, drinking lemonade, listening to the radio on the preacher man.
There are screens everywhere, right?
True.
Or actually just in general reflections, like on car windows.
Okay, hold on one sec. Yes. We're going to go to a break real quick because it's been long enough. But because one of you did correctly guess, I will tell you. I speak as you're here listening to him ramble on and on. You do happen to spy one screen where Enya has pretty much punched Father John right in the face and caused some of his teeth to fly out. It's one screen on a, like, it's like a window tucked away behind a car that's turned over, but you can see it pretty clearly playing, and it looks a little different from the other screens. Because while the other ones may be playing things that, you know, occasionally, like, they happen and then they're isolated in there, this one, it keeps going after the action to show him reeling, grabbing his mouth.
Where did you say it was?
It's like tucked away in a corner somewhere, like behind a car.
Is it, I mean, what is it on?
A window. A
window.
Like a small glass pane, like sort of at the bottom.
I would like to, I assume I'm still like a hose.
Sure, yeah.
I just put the full force of water into that window. I just turn my nozzle suddenly. I would assume one arm is connected to the fire hydrant and the other one is just, it's going all the way through my arms and coming out from the palm of my hand.
I'll tell you, yes, you break it?
Yeah,
I don't. Okay, nothing happens. It's not, you know that something was weird about it, but breaking it is not the solution.
It's not the, okay, so it's not that I break it and then tell Enya to punch him in the jaw.
Right.
Okay.
When you destroy a screen that is playing something, that ends the possibility of it happening.
Oh, okay.
Captures it, and then it can be destroyed and completely eliminated. He demonstrated it earlier.
Okay, so I would know this, that it wouldn't work if I broke it.
If your character is smart enough to know that, then yes, you would.
Okay. But it can be captured?
Hard to say. You have to figure out, I guess, a method to get it to be real.
Okay.
So
doesn't he usually hit it with the paper things before it becomes real?
No, it just isn't real. Like, basically the way moment to moment his stand seems to work is that it captures outcomes on screens. How he actually gets it to be real, you're not sure how he chooses which outcome is going to occur, but there has to be a method to activation of it. In other words, he has something that he does where he picks one outcome on a screen, makes it real, and then it happens. No role required. There has to be something, likely a conscious action that he does.
That he does, okay. So if we could get this in his way as he's choosing it, he might choose the wrong one?
Potentially, it's hard to say.
Okay.
You have to figure out a way to, I would say, yeah, you have to explain. How do you imagine he activates the outcome that he wants? You think he just mentally chooses from a list?
I assume it has something to do with the paper things, but I'm not sure.
Perhaps. But there is one thing that he has that maybe nobody's paid attention to that is probably key to this.
Okay.
I'm not going to say what it is.
All right.
I'm not going to give away, but it is very obvious, actually. Visibly obvious.
It's that obvious.
It's the glasses, correct.
He can see. He can see. If he can use any reflective surface to make a screen, he's wearing two of them.
Of course.
So, you gotta, Enya, you've gotta go full high school bully and take that nerd's glasses.
Well, first you have to figure out how to get him off. Because that every action of you taking them off, he's going to negate.
Of course he is, yeah.
So how do you get him to take off his glasses?
Dirty them.
Dirty them.
Yeah, he's got to take them off and clean them. Just like a nerd would.
I mean...
I will tell you ahead of time to save you time. There is no physical means by which you could remove his glasses. It's simply impossible.
You have to trick him into removing his glasses.
You have to either trick him into removing his glasses or you have to think your way around the problem. But it seems to be, I'd say from the angle that you're at, you can see that he is playing an outcome that he wants on his glasses. You can sort of like see the other side of his sunglasses. He's looking at the outcome that he wants.
Okay.
All other outcomes, he is not looking at, those don't occur.
Well, the first thing that's coming to mind is just trying to tilt her liquid light sword so that it's a glare in his eyes.
Okay, presuming that Ice Peak relays the information.
Yes, of course. I'm literally, like, in her hands, I believe.
So you try to blind him?
Yes.
Go ahead and give me a negotiate roll. All right. I mean, yeah, you managed to temporarily blind him for a moment, split second.
Can she seize that opportunity to move again?
I mean, he has an action.
Yeah.
One. He's going to invoke that he has to do as the good book says. Reroll that. Leave me with a dice pool of three fate points. Two fate points. So that's a three versus a, was it a four?
No.
No, it's a three on his action that he's taking right now. So he holds himself like he's been staggered in a blind. You would want to roll, I think, gaze against that. What are you invoking?
I'm gonna invoke. I want to invoke a silver heart in a cage of bone, just because that's shiny. But I don't know. Does that work? Because if not, I can just invoke black dragonfish. They glow.
Sure, that's fine. Okay. So you are able to see that he is out of his coat. He's pulled one grenade. And he's preparing to thumb off the safety tab, the little pin. He feels like you're going to come close to him. He's about to use this. It seems like he has it prepared in hand, though he is blinded temporarily.
Can I kick him backwards?
Sure, go for it. I guess go for a move on him.
Would that be a precision?
That would be... yeah, we'll make it precision roll. 4 versus, let's see, 1 if you have any other fate points, you can choose to boost them here if you want to put a consequence on them.
Oh yeah, definitely. How much more do I need for a consequence, actually?
You don't need any. I mean, 5 would do it, but you can further boost it if you want to put more damage in on them. Like, if you just invoke once, I think that'll turn that, that turns that 4 into a 6. I mean, then he's taking severe consequence at that point.
Yeah, alright. I'm gonna invoke her motto. Your lives mean so much to me, because in her mind, this guy is just chock full of hostages. That's not cool.
What's the severe consequence you want to put on him?
Actually, yeah, can she just... can his glasses, like, fall off his face?
You really want to make that a severe consequence? Okay.
Yeah, is it possible she can just, like, break them?
Sure.
Cool, I'll take it.
His glasses are broken. So it's just a kick to the face, more or less?
Yeah.
I mean, it's severe consequence. It's more than just, like, broken glasses. I mean, you probably did severe damage. Like, you might have split your skull open.
To maim people, man. But sure.
I was gonna say, didn't Ice Peak see him getting sucker punched and losing some teeth?
Yeah.
Yeah. He...
is this what you want to do? You want to kick some teeth out of his head?
Sure. Yeah. You know, that's fine. Teeth kick, sure.
Okay. You give him a very strong kick in the head. He falls backwards. Or he would have. Once your foot comes in, he actually, with pure comedy, 4 of those arms all rise up, grab you by the leg, tear it off at the hip, and then use it to swing around as a bat into your chest, knocking you way the fuck back into a car. Father John basically takes off the first pair of glasses that were broken, revealing a smaller pair of spectacles behind them that are very thin, and drops the broken pair. Whew. Nice try. Looks like I'm gonna have to get rid of your helper. He grabs you, Ice Peak, and the last thing you see is your body being whipped against a flaming wreckage, piece of wreckage, and then it's lights out. That eel is gone.
He mad.
Yeah. Father John, he's still missing a few, like, one tooth, and there's definitely blood trailing down from his mouth. But you can see he actually pulls the tooth out of his gum, and then at the end of it, an origami bird flies away with missing tooth on a scroll it's holding in its beak. Good as new. He adjusts his clothes. Detective, it's been fun. But I'm afraid now that I've undone all this damage you caused, the only true cure is to get rid of the source. And once I'm done with you, maybe I'll move on to Stella Marie's Police Department next. who am I gonna fool? No. I'll just make them all my Bible officers or some bullshit. They'll go around collecting tithes and whatnot. Or maybe they'll make sure people don't say swears. Isn't that what the Manorettes do? I could make sure that people don't stand too close to school dances. I could make sure that businesses close on Sunday again. Can you believe it? The world is my oyster. The world is my oyster, Detective! He grabs you from the wreckage all arms of pure comedy holding you up into the air. He's just laughing maniacally and begins to, at this point, you're not sure what this is because you're not used to this culture, but if you had experience with old-timey religion, you know, he starts to speak in tongues.
Oh my god, because Enya's like on that cream crack so severely, missing a fucking leg, just listening to this and going, what the hell Eldritch shit is this human saying at me now.
Father John holding you up stops, freezes, looks down at this open sewer nearby, and then looks back at you.
I think it's time for a baptism, detective. I think it's time to wash all the sin away.
He grabs just your whole body, slams you down into the ground repeatedly till you crack the concrete, and then with you in hand jumps down into the sewer before he pushes you head down into the sewer water and starts laughing, screaming, and shaking his head left to right, Manai. Give me that old-time religion!
And that, hates it.
That is where we're going to take a break real quick.
With a good old-fashioned sewer baptism.
He's totally winning.
You're missing a leg. He's currently baptizing you in the sewers. Mikey has a terrible fork wound. And Claudia's on the verge of turning into the fly. What will happen when we return to JoJo, the Dark Angel? Judgment
we got
Night.
It.
Part 2.
We got it. Look, I'm sure. Everybody knows the set in the second act, you've got to have your downs so that you can come up on the third.
Yeah.
No fate points at all. Time to roll those compels, boys. And we still have to get to what Ice Peak's doing, but break time for now.
Okay.
Yeah, please, if you believe in any weird supernatural law,
Jesus.
Please.
Listen, I think the dice just want us to suffer.
You got like 2 good rolls. You got a 6 and a 7. I saw
that. There was 2 good rolls total. I know because I chanted 1 good roll and then 2 good roll. That was it. That was the entirety of the chance.
All right, break time. Also, just, you know, sometimes these guys do extreme violence against you. You can do that sort of thing against them if you ever want, but none of you guys are really all that brutal. You can't do some pretty fucked up shit with super strength. Take advantage when you can. That kick in the face, you could have kicked his head off. Easily. You can easily kick a human's head off. I mean his stand has to get in the way of it, of course, but regular old walking around Father John, you'd kick his head right off. Wouldn't even be hard. Mikey could do it easily.
I would have pumped him full of green crack. Sorry, what? Hi.
You could have pumped him full of green crack as well. I guess that is a possibility. But I mean, his stand would obviously
deflected. Yeah.
How do you fight him? Who knows? Find out when we get back.
Be right back. For the super baptism.
Okay, I'm back.
I'm also here.
Okay. So we have... Yeah, we're waiting for Ice Peak. That's all right, give me one sec. All right, I'm back. Did I speak here?
No.
She's dead, okay.
She's not dead.
Also, can you guys hear my fan over my mic?
I don't think so.
All right, just had to figure out if I had to move it or not.
Just make it the drone of flies.
All right, well, she might have gotten caught up doing some stuff, so I guess we will get to her when she comes back. Right now, we will return the action to Mikey. Mikey, you are dealing with a pretty grievous wound from Alsatia. You are trapped. Long-range weaponry seems to not be in your favor, as she can close in on you extremely quickly or even dive beneath her cover, her sheet. What is one potential thing do you think you could do here?
Yes, I was thinking about it. And running away doesn't seem to be an option. So I guess I got to fall back to another option. I guess I haven't noticed yet that the figures that aren't Alsatia under the cloth are kids, correct?
They look like they might be kids, like hunched over and crawling around on all fours, but it's hard to tell what they are.
Yeah, could I guess roll gaze, because travelers are underneath there, so I should in theory at least have some idea of what's going on.
Sure. Go ahead and give me a gaze roll.
Perfect.
Okay. Beneath the cloth, you catch sight of one of the shapes that are moving. It's not a child. It is a pig.
Okay. So it's just a straight up hog.
Just a, yeah, it's not big. It's kid size, but it is, yeah, it looks like a pig. Hard to tell. It looks like a wild pig to you, not like a domestic one.
Okay. Then in that case, I think not knowing what to do with this knowledge, because player Mikey knows that she sees them as possible kids, but Mikey doesn't know that what she's seeing. I'd like to use the second verse of Travelers where I can make a copy of something that they can perceive and basically out of her cloth, you know, walls, a sprouted pig grows.
Okay, so
I don't know what I would need to roll to do that.
A pig?
Yeah, just gonna plop a pig.
Okay, no roll really necessary for it. It's just you using your ability.
Yeah, and I just want to see how she reacts to that, as there basically being a new pig introduced.
She quickly spins around towards it, and lightning fast, almost as fast as you produce it, the fork is impaling it against the wall, like completely destroying it. Like, also no roll. She just, like, just lightning quick, just speared it against the wall and demolished it. She then quickly runs one of her giant arms over the remains and seems, like, to clench that hand into a fist angrily as it's not giving her actual nutrients.
Okay. Well, that didn't really help. I mean, I guess if she's over there and, I don't know, has her back turned or whatever, I guess I'll try and take another shot at her.
Okay, go for it. Three versus a three. She once again deflects the bullet. And spins around to try and come in towards you with a stab. She pauses, however, because she almost steps on one of the shapes underneath the blanket and steps around it and then comes in on you with a stab once she's around the thing.
Okay.
A seventh.
All right, yeah, I'm going to obviously get out of the way of
that. Okay, go ahead and give me a speed roll. She put a consequence on you earlier, didn't she? You, like, you were pinned.
I was pinned.
Yeah, technically you're still, like, gutted or whatever we'll call it. So she's just going to invoke a +2 on top of her 7 to make that a 9. You rolled a 3. That makes you take 6 incoming stress, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, so now you have the consequence eviscerated. She has further stabbed you a second time with her giant fork. This one sinks in way deeper, does way more organ damage than the first one. You are down to 1 consequence, I believe. And
yes.
You are very close to being taken out. Any other options you can think of here?
Yeah, I guess if there's typically 3 travelers and she just stuck one like a pig, I'm going to make the other 2 also become pigs, but I'm going to keep them under the blanket and I'm just going to have them start running around me in like a defensive manner. Because I noticed that she had to stop. She stopped for the other one and kind of juked it before stabbing me again.
Okay.
So I'm going to have these fake ones exist to hopefully confuse her.
She starts walking around you in a circle, going counter to the pigs. She's scraping her knife and fork against one another to send off more sparks and like leaning in to growl at you, hiss, but she doesn't actually dive in. in her mind, she sees that she's trying to, like, chop a tree, and two children are just playing
Ring Around the Rosie.
And Ring Around the Rosie, right? And she's trying to tell them to stop. She's temporarily stun locked. She doesn't seem to want to go in on an attack just yet. She's trying to size you up for the best way to do it.
I mean, yeah, I guess if I've got her temporarily blocked, I gotta do something. gotta figure it out. Let me go ahead. Let me actually...
Look, it's hard for me not to say anything.
I know. Let me use my stuck with you.
On her?
Yes?
You're trying to stick her in place with one of Travelers.
Yeah.
So the shape under the cloth is going to move towards her?
Yeah, we'll say, yeah, that they would start circling her now instead of me, so she won't... She seems to not want to enter the circle that they're making around me, so if I put the circle around her, in theory, she just has to stay in there.
Okay, she is going to wait for a moment once they're around her. Oh my god. I think you need some kapows here.
I'm killing it. What are you talking about? Top of my class.
You can see, by the way, the blood that was like appearing under her cloth earlier has pretty much gone away. She has a stunt where she gets a massive bonus to a roll. Once she delivers a consequence, however, that goes away. So she just heals away a consequence she gives to herself. You currently, like, we'll say with a zero, she's like willingly stuck, but it seems like she has enough range and speed to get out of this. Just right now, she actually will lean down towards one of the lumps and like try to grab at it. Right now, the wounds that she delivered onto you earlier, you're starting to convert into food stuff. Like, you can feel some of your organs turning into bunches of grapes, for example. Or you may have like a your liver is turning into a broccoli. And the more that those things are converting, the harder it is for you to glurp and glurp around as well. You're not as technically boneless. You have these like chunks of solid vegetable mass inside of yourself.
Great. I'm just slowly turning into a salad.
You are. You can see Alsatia is actually, she puts down her knife and fork onto the ground and picks up one of the traveler bundles with her own hands and just starts cradling it in her arms while it still has the blanket bunched up. It looks like she's holding a baby, and now she's leaning down to try and grab the other moving travelers to get the second child. I'd say you have a free action here, but you're really, really on the ropes. What would you like to do?
Can I guess, shed all of my food stuff parts and then, I guess, just make myself really small? Yeah, become baby.
Okay, this is going to be, it's extremely painful for you. This is basically you taking yourself out. Unlike Ice Beak, you're not a swarm.
Yeah, no, I shouldn't be doing this, but there are. I'm already full of parts that aren't me, so I just need to get them out and keep what is still me.
Okay, so what you're basically doing is surrendering the fight at this point. You having to regather yourself and like regain molecular control enough to like put up a fight as you normally would, just not really going to happen quick enough, as compared to how fast your opponent is. However, even in this compressed form, I'll say, I mean, saying that you are surrendering, correct? By turning into a baby?
Yeah, I see that whatever she thinks those little pigs are, she's treating them like kids, so maybe she won't eat a kid?
Okay, I'm gonna just copy and paste it, because, like, fucking it's killing me. Her trouble is children must live. In this case, she sees you turn into a baby. She kind of just casually reaches over and grabs you with one of her giant arms, picks you up, puts you underneath the tucks you underneath the arm, and then goes back to trying to grab the other moving children under the sheet. Once she gathers enough of them, the sheet begins to recede back towards the sheet that is living on her. And then she starts to walk, basically, out of the building very slowly. The hands that were gliding along, like, on platforms have receded back into her normal bare feet. And she's just walking around, just holding you. All in all, in her grip, you can tell she's A, extremely strong, and B, a little bit cold. For a human, at least. But she... You have, like, your innate sense of, like, animal versus animal action. She has zero killing intent towards you at this point. So she's just going to carry you. And if you... You have to figure out a way to get out of this, because you don't know where she's planning on taking you. But it's probably not back to the police station, so you can file a missing person report for yourself.
Yeah.
For now, that is the fate of Detective De La Cruz. He has returned to baby.
Look, I can't return to monkey. That's not how we started.
Has Mikey ever been a baby?
Yeah, I think his backstory was that he washed up on shore as just like a weird, like, seaweed wrapped like slug with like probably like some little like vestigial limbs that would develop. And that's how he got picked up by his adoptive parents, was that they thought there was a person or something on the beach. And they found me.
A gooey boy.
Yeah, just absolute slimy boy.
Mikey, in case you need a reminder about who you're dealing with, however, as she leaves the building, one of the mob members just runs at her with a machete. She puts one of her giant arms through the person's head and pushes a hamburger off of his shoulders. The body falls over and spills French fries with ketchup out of its neck wound. She holds the hamburger towards one of the bundles in her arms and then shoves it into the bundle, causing it to be absorbed into the white sheet.
Great. That's fine.
From this behavior, you can tell she is feeding her quote-unquote children. And, oh my god, you know what? Now that you're this close and just, like, being held by her, you can see what looked like actually the shape of children clinging to her body beneath the sheet. Just some faces occasionally, or, like, a small arm. They're all just clinging to her in various positions.
Yeah, I was gonna say, if I just, like, just pretend that, like, I'm grabbing at the cloth of her material and slip a traveler's in, can I better see or communicate with these children?
You can. Unpleasant note, she is not wearing, clothes beneath the sheet.
I'm a giant slug, man. I don't, whatever.
I know.
Her weird mummified corpse is not going to be the weirdest thing I touch.
She is
forensics.
She's very... Department. Yeah, since you're a forensics guy and you probably have some medical knowledge, she has the body of, like, somebody that hasn't eaten in, like, weeks, I'd say. Like, maybe not long enough to be dead, but, like, actually consistently malnourished. She is not wearing, like, her clothes, if she had any, are pretty much tattered rags beneath there. The children are also extremely skinny. that are clinging to her body. They're ethereal. They're not like completely solid. So they're just all clinging to her at very, like, just almost like monkeys on branches. Some of them look like they were once originally a much larger shape for a child, but have like reverted down, almost like shrunken to this shape from being like underfed and whatever black magic is responsible for keeping her alive. And they are all kind of, now that you're in this close, you can hear they're all kind of humming the same song among one another, and occasionally singing in very weak voices. Sister Alsatia, Sister Alsatia, bring us lunch, bring us lunch. Sister Alsatia, Sister Alsatia, hold us bunch, hold us bunch. They're just all singing this pretty much in unison.
I will commit that song to memory for when I slide out of her arms. I can sing it and hopefully not get murdered.
Are you gonna slide out of her arm?
I'll start singing it and just, I'll still cling to her like the other kids, but I'll slowly work my way down her, like down the dress and everything like that.
Okay. So you get your way out of the sheet. When you do, and you start singing a song and like basically getting away. Is that what you're trying to do?
Yeah, I'm singing the song. If anything, I'll sing the song, and as I climb down her, Travelers just kind of appears like where I was, and is also like climbing down her. And so like when I drop off, there's still the weight of something or someone, so that it isn't like, where's my baby? I need to go grab it.
She will, well, I mean, let's see if she may notice this, she may not, let's see. You have to roll a speed against a zero.
Man, never tell me the odds.
A three. You succeed with advantage. Not only do you get away from her without her noticing, but she is, another one of her children is distracting her currently. So you have advantage on her if you're trying to escape or you want to launch an attack.
No, I'm literally like a fourth of my normal size, given that Mikey's so fucking tall normally. I think I would just leave. I like fly off like a flying squirrel or something. Just gone.
She looks seemingly over her shoulder to see you, but doesn't seem to actually notice. She's too slow. And you can tell from how she's moving, the fight actually caused her to overexert herself, so she's starting to look sluggish and dazed, like someone with low blood sugar. She stumbles against a wall and braces herself, and then grabs her head and just holds there for a moment. And then looks around, takes one of her giant forks out from beneath her sheet, grabs it with two of her normal hands, and starts to look, peek under cars. It's like she remembered what she was doing, but now she has lost you for the moment.
I'm just imagining this giant woman one-handing, lifting a car up and just putting it down.
Mikey, however, you're not alone. As you are flying away, something is clinging to you.
I guess I look down. Do I have a ghost kid stuck to me?
You have one ghost child clinging to your body. It's staring at you with the driest eyes possible. It hasn't made a sound yet, but it might. That ghost child is, where is she? There she is, this one. In this human form, she would have looked like just an average girl. In her malnourished form, she's about 2 feet tall with an enormous head, visible ribs, skeletal fingers, curled up into a ball, just clinging to you and staring at you with the widest, driest eyes possible.
I think I would look at this little ghost girl, and despite like how far I might be, like how high I might be in the air, I guess I would just like look at her and just go, hi, do you need to go back, or are you okay?
Mike, as you're leaving, you hear a very distant howl.
I think I need to get you back to your, is it your mom? I don't know a lot, and she doesn't really talk. Do you talk?
The little ghost girl clinging to you starts, she's whispering something, but it's way too quiet to hear.
No, hey, I'm sorry, sweetie. You gotta speak up.
The howl is getting a little bit louder now.
No, okay, hang on. I guess I would land and try and get her, like, set her down or, like, get her off of me so I can... Okay, now what were you saying?
First of all, you cannot get rid of her. She will not let go of you, and when you try to touch her, your hand actually just goes through her. Okay. Even, yeah, she's just holding you.
Yeah, I think he tries that, yeah, and his hands just go through her and just like, crap. As ridiculous as it looks, he, I guess, like, twists and bends his head and neck so that he can, like, listen to what she's saying. Like, just ear to her little ghost mouth.
You so want to hear? Yeah.
Yeah, I need to know what she's saying. As I listen to, like, the howls getting closer.
We're all hungry. We're going to hell. We're all hungry. We're going to hell. We're all hungry. We're going to hell.
Okay. I guess like he would immediately look around to see if he can see Alsatian, and then just go, okay, here, and he just like holds his hand out over her head and just starts dripping like food goo. Like it's just his goop, but it's like he's doing like the mental molecular control to like make it nutritious. Or like not necessarily nutritious, but like if you ate it, it would be good for you and not is normal, like it heals you, it patches you up. It's just, it's all, yeah, it's just vitamins. Yeah, it's just like if you took a bunch of plants, blended them up, and then just tried to force feed it.
She eats the weird Vitagoo and then vomits it directly onto the street just right away.
Oh, was that? And I guess he'll, like, he'll go from, like, he'll, like, slow the drip down to, like, a single, like, drop and see if, like, maybe it's just...
She eats one drop and immediately throws up twice as much volume as she did the first time, getting smaller every time that she does it.
That shouldn't be possible. That shouldn't be possible. Oh, Okay, what did you eat? What do you eat? And he just bends down again.
Sister Alsatia feeds us. We're going now. Sister Alsatia feeds us. We're going now.
Okay. Well, she turns stuff into food, and I can kind of make food. It's like a... And he just like kind of shrugs like his hands.
She stares at you for a moment. You're still close enough, right?
Yeah.
She just starts whispering, she's going to kill you. She's going to kill you.
I don't want her to.
She's going to kill you. She's going to kill you. She's going to kill you. She's going to kill you.
Look, I don't understand this, your whole thing.
Run.
Okay, get out. And he just, yeah, I immediately take back up. Yep. No, I guess I just have a ghost kid.
Yeah, the ghost is still clinging to you. She won't let go. For now...
I think as he's flying, he just says like something under his breath of like, when I see Ice Peak, I'm gonna get this ghost off of me.
For now, Mikey, you have one ghost clinging to you. You hear what sounds like the terrible sound of metal rending too far away. You may only see one half of a car flying around the corner. But it matches the location of the howl. So currently, Sister Alsatia is raging because she realized she's missing a kid.
Nah, she's got little travelers. It's the same thing.
Oh, no. She's missing the one that you have clinging to you.
I know, but there's travelers there. That should count.
Nope. No. She's been carrying these ghosts for over millennia. A thousand.
Yeah, yeah.
She knows the exact weight of each ghost.
For now, you have one baby, and technically you're full up on consequences. So that is kind of what's happening with you. It'll take you some time to regenerate, but for now, you are considered taken out. So that's what happens with Mikey. Sister Alsatia is currently on the hunt. Mikey is on the run. He has one baby that he stole because he kidnaps children now.
I was going to say, for the severe consequence, should I just put that I have a cursed child clinging to me?
Yeah, I guess.
Because it's like a severe one you have to like pay to get rid of or like work down, right?
Typically.
Supposedly, yeah.
In a JoJo game, however, it feels like that. I don't know. Like, that's real iffy. That's
they
like
put bandages on you and you're better instantly.
Yeah, kind of. Like, Kakuin going blind technically is a severe consequence.
Okay, well, I don't know how long it's going to take for me to get rid of this kid, so severe consequence is my clingy cursed child.
You have one clingy cursed baby. Okay, so that's what's happening with you. Now, real quick, I will real quick cover Claudia, what's happening with you, Claudia, and then we'll move to Ice Peak and what's happening with her and the mob now that she's cut off from Enya. So, Claudia, if you're still here, hopefully.
Yep.
Okay. You are currently dealing with the metamorphosis is rising, and out of the darkness has emerged the king drone that Rhesus Negative had summoned as a stand. His head is now sticking out of its mouth, just like the drone flies he makes. It hasn't fully consumed him or anything. It's almost like he's wearing it like armor or using it as a vehicle. But that is his new setup and form. With that in mind, what is your next course of action here?
I don't know, really. I guess she's probably going to just start probing for a weakness in this thing. Something that she could exploit.
Okay. To do that, you're going to have to roll a gaze, I would say, to try and see if there's anything you can suss out about how its form looks. Two. Hard to say, though his chosen arena probably has something to do with it. Not just his chosen arena, but like the tactics that he's using all seem to be leaning towards, or rather, defensive of something. This is a hint I could give you, like two engages. You could get more information as a compel, but it's going to put you in a difficult situation. You are a trouble sniffer, technically. So I could technically just compel you, and you wouldn't be able to resist, I suppose, if you want.
So that's fine.
Yeah. Okay.
I would like at least one fate point back, so sure.
Okay. He is going to just straight up, once he is out, or rather in his form, he's going to reach out with one arm covered in spines and rake it across your body as he flies past you, leaving a jet stream of force. This attack is coming in with a +2.
Oh boy.
It's a 0. That's okay, because he's going to re-roll that as he invokes that his stand World Eater allows him to gain speed beyond human comprehension. +2. I'll live with it. That makes it a 4.
Okay.
You're going to have to roll speed to get out of the way, I suppose.
Okay.
+0.
Cool.
I mean, you got a fate point. You can bank it if you want, but you'll have to roll that 1d2.
Let's see. I guess I'll roll that 1d2 because...
All right. You've been really good on the coin flips, but you do take 4 incoming stress. Which I think is... Oh, yeah. Okay. You're okay. Pretty high up there now.
Yeah.
But the compel was interesting. As he flew by you, you saw something in his ears. Looked like, couldn't tell. So it's almost like something was put into them.
Oh,
plugs or something.
Okay.
Those plugs did not look like they were made from any normal material. It may be part of his stand. Otherwise, though, he just blasts off into the darkness and hits a curve, comes back at you again. You have time to make an action, though. What would you like to do?
Sure. Kind of wait until he's... She'll probably start moving and move close to where a wall is, and then wait until he comes right after, and then, like the drone before, try to dodge out of the way just in time so he maybe hits the wall.
He is going to fly at you and plant the fly's feet along the wall, pinning you against it with this massive fly body of his. He currently has advantage that he seems to have more awareness of the environment somehow, and use that to ascertain at high speed that if he was to make a maneuver like that, he would just get out of the way. He doesn't fall for it, basically. Not only that, he uses it as an opportunity against you. So now you have your fate point, but he has a +2 to his roll.
Okay.
It is your action, however. He just took his.
Since he's got me pinned, I think what she'll actually do is kind of heat up her hands and then just start rapidly just clapping them together like some kind of kind of like that monkey
with the symbols?
Yes. Except that superhuman speed.
Alright, go for it. Give me a roll. This seems like a power roll because you're using force of strength to rapidly, yeah, powerfully clap your hands together. So you do have a fade point, see how it goes for you.
A 2. Okay.
Well, I mean, let's see what it gets.
Ooh.
A 1. That makes his roll a 3. You have a fate point.
Oh boy. Yeah, I'll bump that up just to do something to him.
Guys, do you just want to clap rapidly?
Yeah, kind of hoping to damage those little things on his ears.
You can see he's going to take a compel right now. You can see that his ears are starting to bleed, but he takes this opportunity to +2 his own roll. That he is ruthless. His greatest sin, he strangled his own younger brother at the man's wedding. He doesn't care about what it takes to get something done. He just gets it done. So he takes that, basically takes the damage, but manages to get in close enough to reach in with 2 hands full of spines as he emerges from the fly as a torso, and uses them to pin your hands to the walls, each with one, like a bundle of spines in each of them. Go ahead and roll me another 1d2.
All right.
And you take 1 physical stress.
I don't have any. I guess I have mild consequence.
Mild consequence, yeah. Your hands are impaled with these spines.
Okay.
He emerges more from the fly with more bundles of these spines gathered like arrows or daggers in his grip. And with your hands pinned and your body pinned against the wall, he seems to be preparing to deliver a death blow to you. One more level, one more failed roll and you go through metamorphosis, and it seems like he has enough range, speed, and opportunity to stab you multiple times. So this is pretty much going to decide what happens. Claudia, you have the choice. You have a choice here. Do you lower your pitch or raise your pitch?
I suppose she will lower it.
Okay. In that case, you are pinned to a wall. You are currently facing potential annihilation here. You have this feeling that something about your voice is off. You need to correct it. So you lower it. And as a result of you lowering your voice, let's see. I don't know what I did with the... What is this one? You hear a voice not your own speak.
Thought you had me outgunned, Bandejo. Jaguar clan doesn't die that easy.
Your hand rips away from the spines by the wrists, breaking off, and a new hand emerges from the wrist. A man's hand wielding a machete in it. Rhesus Negative barely has time to let go and dodge backwards as the machete comes swinging down towards him at a deadly angle and with extreme precision. Your other hand, you can free it now if you want from the wall. You're still currently on the edge of metamorphosis, but you hear a second voice kind of talking to you from inside your own head.
Detective Cornell, if you die here, who's going to avenge me? Come on. Just this once, see what it's like to be a samurai.
Right now, Claudia, your hand, that is not your own hand, you recognize as Torito's, is holding his blade control machete. You currently have access to its abilities.
Okay.
Just like playing music with Torito, this is a duet number. Anytime you roll evens, it's an automatic success no matter what you're trying to do. On top of that, you can control severed limbs of anybody, including the corpses around the arena, any limb you manage to sever off of Rhesus or his flies, or even your own. The sword is extremely sharp as well.
Okay.
You have the next action. What would you like to do? Rhesus seems to be playing it defensive because he doesn't understand what the fuck just happened.
In theory, if I say cut off both mine and Rhesus' hand at the same time, would I be able to control both of them to, say, immediately attack this man? Got me pinned and starts just reaping into his face.
Oh no, he moved away from you as soon as your sword hand came.
Okay.
He fucked right off. But technically, if you sever one of his limbs, you could definitely use it to attack him. You could sever one of your own limbs to do the same. Any limb of your own that you cut with control machete is not considered a consequence at all.
Okay. Then in that case, it is going to be a little fucked, but maybe what she does is, since he's moving away, one of her, I think one of her arms maybe kind of heats up, and right as it heats up, she cuts it and sends it like a rocket right into his face.
Okay, go ahead and give me a speed roll for that.
Okay.
A three. He rolls a three. Right now, he barely manages to duck out of the way of this thing or dodge out of it. Like, he twists his whole body to avoid being scorched by this rocket punch, but it does go close enough to char some of his skin. He's going to kind of screech in this mute manner as he arches his back. It sounds pathetic. It's the most his voice can muster as he just tries to call in these drone flies to all strike out at you. That's a six incoming. Roll your dice.
Okay. Speed or?
Whatever you decide. Speed sounds fine though.
Okay.
A four. You automatically succeed on your defense. How do you do it? You just duck out of the way?
I imagine, yeah, she probably quickly follows the tempo of, follows an hidden tempo and just starts moving to a separate beat, kind of like tapping her feet and then moving to the rhythm.
Okay. There is one that you missed, but your machete arm flies up and just cleaves it out of the air before it even makes contact as you find yourself, I guess, in a fighting stance, but your sword is being held in a complementary defensive pose. The arm seems like it still has its own set of controls, but it's working perfectly in concert with you. It is your action now. You do have one severed bug on the ground, cut by control machete.
All right. Then she'll kind of move to the nearest undead corpse and just cut it away and then start basically she's basically going to start just making turn this whole arena from his into hers by severing as many limbs as possible and just sending them right at him.
Sure. I guess give me a precision roll.
Okay.
It's an automatic success. She takes 4 physical stress. So. He is looking rather battered at this point in the darkness. You can tell that the reason that these are successes automatically is he does not know what he's dealing with and technically is fighting 2 combatants at the same time without realizing it. Instead of continuing the fight, he is going to pull back fully into the body of World Eater and send it crashing through the ceiling structure. It takes 1, 2, 3 rams of its body, causing the shell to crack slightly. 2. He's going to try and escape through the hole that he made. But he is not faster than you if you want to catch him.
At this point, I think when he's about to do it, I think she kind of cuts another body, but this time, as she cuts, she's singing so that all of her stones go off at once, like the trap that she said earlier.
Ah. Okay. So you're sending another barrage of limbs at him?
And sending another barrage of limbs
and setting off the trap?
Yes.
All right. Yeah, at this point, he's got like two consequences you haven't invoked yet. So I guess go ahead and just give me a speed roll against his speed roll, see if you can catch him out. You have two invokes for plus twos.
All right. Oh, come on.
I mean, that makes it an automatic success. You roll evens.
Yeah. Ooh.
In which case, yes, and you are a Slayer type. So
yes.
I think that means, let's see, conditions caused. Oh, Jesus. That makes your two into an eight, actually. So in that case, he is taken out. The combination of all the limbs flying and the sound going off and then the crumbling in of the ceiling falling in on him at the same time, all of it crushes him and traps him inside of the body of World Eater. On top of that, there's a giant rock kind of punched through some of the damage that you did earlier, impaling him. He starts to try and pull himself out of World Eater slowly. You can tell his body is heavily wounded as he does it, and he's crying. He looks rather pathetic outside of the body of his stand, and he's bleeding in the same place that it got impaled. With a bundle of spines in his fist, he starts to swing wildly at the darkness. Can't seem to get a lock on where you are. He's facing the entire wrong direction. You have one fly at your mercy here, Claudia. What will you do?
This man is... he was doomed to die, so I mean, she's probably going to squish that.
The man that is crawling around rhesus negative, you're going to just step on him?
Pretty much. I mean, the only other option I could even think of is I don't think I can actually do it.
What's that? You need to petrify him.
Oh.
I mean, that is the second verse of your stand.
Yeah, then she'll petrify him.
Okay. How does Claudia petrify somebody in this case? You just put a stone on him, I guess, or?
Usually the stones kind of like form a little fine powder, and then once the powder is on them, they slowly turn into petrified coral. Usually. That's how I imagined it.
He, as he's dying, turns his head into your direction, and you can see clenched between his teeth his last speaking device. It just says this on the feed.
You have found me. Hello, detective. You have found me. Hello, detective. You have found me. Hello, detective. You have found
me. And with that, he just petrifies and crushes the device between his teeth, causing it to stop playing. This man has been killed. He is now coral. The body begins to crack. Flies begin to stream out of the statue of Rhesus Negative. Otherwise, he is dead.
Oh boy.
You now have an option. Or rather, the voice that spoke to you earlier gives you this option.
You have avenged me, detective. For that, I am eternally grateful. But now, I have no reason to cling to this world. I will depart then, if that is all right with you.
Of course, you've earned your rest.
You're going to have to cut me off.
All right, and then I guess she'll probably figure out a way because she's got no arm left, so I guess with her teeth.
I mean, you can just make like a stone blade with your out of your stand, more or less.
Yeah. Then.
All right. Once the hand falls to the ground, the blade falls with it, sinks into the ground a bit, and you feel lighter as a voice, fading voice, says to you,
"See you on the other side, chica."
And then, like that, your ability to play the guitar much, much better than you used to fades along with the voice. The spirit of Corrido Zopilote has moved on. You have gotten revenge for him. So too, the spirit of Rhesus Negative seems to fade, leaving you alone in a room full of gore. Dead drones, they're beginning to just drop out of the sky now that Rhesus is dead. And silence. The droning buzz of the flies has ceased.
Oh boy, she's probably gonna take in the sight for now and just relax.
No, there's no time to relax. You have a show to go to. You punch through the ceiling, climb out, walk through a wall, just completely walk through it, and just start speed walking away from the Golgotha tenements.
Oh, boy.
For now, Claudia is taken out. Congratulations, you joined the ranks of the illustrious Mikey De La Cruz. At some point, Mikey, you even maybe will see Claudius power walking out of the Golgotha tenements, walking through walls.
Like, just, she's not, like, vibrating through them, she's just hulking her way?
Just hulking her way right through them.
I feel like... Well, no, wait, our comms are still down, so I can't even, like, be like, hey, what are you doing without stopping? And I am trying to find IEspeak to get this ghost kid off of me.
The moment, yeah, you even consider the word stop, you hear the howl way off, but you hear it.
Yeah. And I'm just like, nope, we're not doing that. Claudia's a separate issue. She doesn't seem to be hurting anyone. She's just kind of doing something.
She's busy. She's got a show to go to.
I don't know that, and I don't care.
Okay, so that leaves, oh man, it's getting towards the end. Jeez.
It's okay, wrap up.
Okay. That leaves Enya getting a sewer baptism currently, and IEspeak. IEspeak, once your head landed over where Mikey flung you, you are dealing with, there's angry mobs running around everywhere. A few of them just kick your head around, not even looking.
Oh, okay.
What would you like to do here?
I saw, or have I seen Cortland when I was flying above everyone?
No, you wouldn't have seen him.
Okay, but I know where I need to go.
Vaguely.
Yeah, the shop. So I'm going to turn into a ham so I can crawl along.
Okay.
Okay.
You're given pause, I'll say, because you hear gunfire.
Uh-huh.
As you can hear someone screaming and then someone else screaming, "There he is! He's over there!"
Oh no.
More gunfire. Pinned down in the hardware store with his back to a broken window and an old shotgun in his hands, blood running down his face from a cut along his cheek, Cortland is loading more shotgun shells into this old piece that the hardware store owner kept behind the counter.
Oh.
He springs up to shoot someone in the leg, causing everyone behind him to fall over that first person, and then turns and fires center mass at somebody that was jumping at him with an axe. He pumps the shotgun and turns, points it directly in someone else's face that was coming in at him with a crowbar. That person drops the crowbar. Cortland takes a moment. Does he consider the law of the land, the law of the sea, or the law of the sky, I speak?
What does he consider?
That's up to you. What would you have tried to, I guess, pass along in your discussions on any topic? Your beliefs, your morality, your ethics, your philosophies?
She regrets being Avicii's servant. So when she was forced to come up on land and like feed off people, it made her feel like a monster. So she does everything in her power to follow the laws of the land to the letter, because she doesn't understand the difference between survival and living.
In that case, Cortland leans down and just shoots this guy point blank in the kneecap.
Oof.
Blowing off the lower half of his leg, but leaving him alive. The man screams and rolls around, causing everyone else to back up a step. Now they've seen a few people take shotgun fire and they're trying to recoil as Cortland pumps the shotgun and aims it out at the crowd. He doesn't say anything, but he does lean down without looking to check the pulse of the shop owner who is currently bleeding out. He looks down at his Uzique that the shop owner was able to provide him with, but that's not working. He isn't sure what to do in this situation, but because you have told him that it was good to follow the law of the land, he's going to not try to butcher his way out of this. However, his hesitation and his reliance on principles of society and its structure might leave him vulnerable, as though there are people retreating, seeing that there's a break in the gunfire, there are those that are coming now with guns against him. They are getting ready, pulling out pistols. One of them has a submachine gun. All older models, likely stuff they bought on the street, black market firearms that exist in Guam. But they were able to get them probably at a scalper's fee, considering the frenzy going on out here. He will have to deal with perhaps greater consequences because of following the law.
Mm-hmm.
You are just a hand crawling around on the street. So what would you like to do? Now you have like a sort of general idea of where he might be.
Yeah, how far am I?
I'd say you are close enough that you can see, once you actually follow the direction of the gunfire, you can see that Cortland has been disarmed of his shotgun and is being dragged out through the window.
Oh, okay. Can I crawl up and grab someone who's tried to drive him away?
You have to deal with the mob.
Yes, can I get to the window sill?
You want to try to get between him and the mob?
Well, I'm just going to electrify the windowsill.
Oh, you're going to... Well, he's on it, though. He's making contact with the two. If you do that, you're going to shock him.
Yeah, a little.
It's but... more than a... Okay. go for a power roll, I guess.
It's not much of me to do this.
I understand. Hachi Machi. Cortland takes 4 physical stress.
Oh no, that's so much! What about the people?
The people, let's see what they take. The mob takes 4 physical stress.
Come on, are they distracted at all by the sudden pileup of people that are being electrocuted?
I mean, yeah, of course they're distracted, but also Cortland is having a seizure because you just electrocuted him and he's fresh out of the hospital, man.
Yeah, I understand. Can I make it so that their bodies fall on him?
You want their bodies to fall on him?
Just for a moment, I'm using it as a cover before I crawl on his face, become a mask of Ice Peak's male face.
I understand your maneuver that you're going here for, but they know who they grabbed. He's wearing identifiable clothes. You'd have to do a full body, and they're all looking. They're all
no. There. I don't have enough to do a full body, so yeah. I was hoping I could try to collapse the entire thing, and then he could act like one of them. But I guess not.
No, I mean he's currently having a seizure. They're currently the mob that were grabbing onto him are electrocuted. That's the situation here. So you got that going.
Sorry, I was trying for a spy thing. I didn't get there.
That's okay. He doesn't really seem to know that you did anything, at least. I mean, he's just as confused as anyone. No. In his mind, somebody must have hit him with a taser or something.
Oh, I zapped Court. I didn't mean to zap. Okay.
Can I warned you.
I know. Can I push him out the window? How much is out there?
It's rough to try to push him away with your little bit of mass.
I'm barely a hand,
him.
Yes.
I guess it's up to you. How would you have, like, you still have your stand. You still have some parts, I guess, of the working mind. You have some small amount of mass.
But I assume the shopkeeper isn't a corpse yet.
No, Cortland was trying to keep him alive.
Yeah, he's alive, so I don't have... I can just start punching people. They don't see it, I guess.
You want to try to punch the mob?
I've never used my sand to punch a single person, so yeah, I guess.
All right, go for a power roll, I suppose. Let's see how they do. Actually, they just take... You can tell they're just taking the punches. They don't actually... try to defend themselves. The ones that are like seemingly the main muscle, they just take it, and instead are focused on grabbing Cortland.
Oh, there's so many.
As you're striking at the crowd, trying to get them off of Cortland, for a moment he's out of view of you.
Oh no.
And you can see that they are, let's see. For a moment, a brief second, I'll say, when the crowd moves again so that you can see where Cortland was, Cortland isn't there. Instead, what you see for a moment is what looks like a panicked deer. Wide-eyed, foaming at the mouth. When the crowd passes over again as they try to close in on him and they part ways, it's just Cortland again.
Ow.
Long ago, Leroy told you a story. He wanted to give people a gift, and so he provided innocence in the form of a deer who didn't know sin but was born into a world where his flesh was delicious and he could be consumed as prey. A deer who just wanted to survive, wanted to walk in the grass, wanted to live. And the people, starving masses, saw in him their salvation, their meal, their prey. And so they killed his deer. And when they did that, that was where the catastrophe that you're currently experiencing was born. If the mob manages to kill or otherwise win in this battle for Cortland, there is no small chance that a catastrophe will occur. And that is where we're going to end the session. Congratulations.
So, Cortland's polite deer?
He is the polite deer, yeah. Plus he's... He's got that disc in his head. Got
a bow
to him.
Oh my god.
And there you have it, Judgment Night Part 2. Mikey has gotten in touch with his childhood. Claudia did a successful duet and now has a show to go to. And Ice Peak has come face to face with what is perhaps the original sin.
Oh!
Wow. That's a lot.
I know this ending file took a huge amount of time to load up because it's a huge file, but that's okay.
It's doing it, and slowly.
You don't know how hard this remix was to find.
Just slowing it, find the slowdown.
With an additional beat added to it, yeah.
I would have assumed that you made it yourself.
Nope. I ain't that talented. Only one of us here has sound engineering experience, and it ain't me. It's Mikey, I think.
Yes.
For video engineering.
Yeah.
Video experience. I will say next session, Mikey, you'll no longer be taken out. Like, you would have had time to recover somewhat from
being... I'm just hiding in dumpsters and, on rooftops, and I'm just like, look, kid, you gotta get off. I don't know if I can just hand you back to Alsatian. You gotta go. Come on.
The after credit scene, by the way, are cops flooding into the Golgotha tenement. As you may have noticed on the radio chatter, they've noticed that you guys went blackout in that area and that your squads aren't responding either. So currently, away from where you are, there are cops clashing with rioters.
Oh, good.
Wow, that's good.
Yes.
We should definitely use some.
Congratulations on killing Rhesus Negative. Did we? Yeah, he's dead.
Okay.
Yeah, he's definitely dead. Pretty hard to get a fucking band-aid for being turned into coral. He doesn't have molecular control.
It's not that, it's just that all his flies went someplace. I just hope he doesn't be plaguey, is what I'm saying, I guess.
Oh, it's those last
flies. Yeah. Oh, his stand stopped working too.
Oh, okay.
Oh, good.
Show to go.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure you're going to come out of that fugue state as well, Claudia. It's just right now.
Yeah.
Because of the option you chose, you suddenly have whiplash in another direction.
That's fair. I mean, I did think of another way to take him out, but yeah, I wasn't sure it was actually going to work or it made sense.
Yeah, that's fine. So I guess we'll find out what happens next week on Judgment Night Part 3. Potentially the last part. Depending on how it goes. Enya will have to resolve her fight with Father John. Mikey will have to figure out, I guess, how he can support one person or another. And I guess thanks to Claudia. You guys will have to, as the city is, as Golgotha tenements are raging right now.
Mikey's gonna have to figure out how to child support.
I mean, she doesn't eat because she just keeps spitting out everything I give her, so
yeah,
I guess I'm saving money there.
you can just go to an exorcist, you know, to get that blows.
Just call up an exorcist.
Well, the best one I knew is currently the Antichrist, so.
So Dorley.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah, that's true. But is he?
She's set to retire, so.
Also, I don't think it would be good if I just come running in with a ghost child on my hip and I'm just like, Dorley, get her off!
You think that's the first time she's had to deal with that?
No.
With a ghost child?
Yeah, but I don't know how she would handle a ghost child.
Maybe the last time he has to deal with a ghost child, she's like, I quit. As soon as she sees the ghost child.
We could always ask Miyavi if he's experienced in exorcism at all. As a
you know he'll just cut that kid in half, right?
Probably.
But if he cuts her in half, then he becomes, yeah, I'll say she becomes his.
But he's problem. The child killer, and I'm completely washed of all responsibility.
Look, for all Alsatia might know, I didn't even see the kid because I didn't know I had a ghost kid on me.
I was just walking around and the RV came sliced the kid off.
Yeah, that'll. She'll just hear all that and go, mm-hmm.
Oh, no.
That's weird. How are you gonna.
She's
so reasonable, yeah. She just turned you into a fucking stir fry. Mikey Teriyaki.
Yeah.
I see, you killed one of my children?
Gonna turn you into Mikey Lomain.
Run, Mikey.
How do you guys like that? Now, this is actually the first time Alsatia's had any character, I think, other than being quiet and threatening.
Yes.
Did people like your backstory?
Yeah, I cried.
Okay, good.
Man, it was rough.
She is always hallucinating that she's just feeding the children and playing.
Feeding
games,
the hungry
so.
Children, yeah.
Yeah, I thought
she... Okay, confirm for me. Did the devil start the plague?
No.
No, okay.
No, all those were just natural disasters that occurred. I mean, he didn't...
All at once.
Yeah,
I think that is legitimately some of the shit that actually happened.
Yes, you can look it up. 536 is considered the worst year to have been alive. Those are all real facts.
Yeah, I'm gonna ask.
Yeah.
That was real, or did you just made that up?
No, the plague is horrible.
The plague is horrible, and then you had a bunch of other shit.
Like, if you've ever listened to anything about the plague, like a podcast, you will quickly realize it was like hell on earth.
Yes. you had plague, you had a bunch of other natural disasters, you had people spreading the plague by being flatulence, which is you know, fun little edit there.
What happened was, like what I said, pretty much volcanoes went off around the world and clouded the sun out with ash for roughly a year, and it was enough to lower global temperatures enough to cause like several different like emergencies at once. And the world was colder too for that whole year and darker. Like there were times people go outside and they'd swear it's like basically night, like they gave up on the sun.
Yeah, you probably couldn't even tell what time it was, how much time had even passed, because it was caked with ash.
They sincerely thought God was mad.
You could have called it, if you wanted to, a little dark egg.
No.
Oh my god. I see. Thank you.
So please tune in next time. I know the session went on a little long. Yeah.